And hello, welcome to solo playthroughs. We are in for a interesting one. I think it'll be a good one. I hope it'll be a good one. This game's really nuts. If it's not a good one, it's going to be my fault, not the game's fault. I promise you that. There's something very different about Darkest Night 2nd Edition compared to my normal fare of games that I feature. And I don't know if I'll be able to be all that articulate about that. I think that there's something about this game that just feels like a passion project. I get the sense that the designer of this game worked on this game forever and really came together with a really amazing array of abilities and characters. And yeah, there's a lot of tropes and the normal fantasy realm, and we have nymphs and conjurers and fortune tellers and knights and valkyries and all of it, but they just really all play very different, even though it's a very tight system that's relatively simple. You have one action. What are you doing? You're traveling? You're gonna rest? You're gonna do an action on your card? I mean, it is what it is. You just have one action. But there's a lot of forethought that needs to happen in this game, a lot of planning, a lot of hunting for clues that sometimes just never come. And there are times where I'll be an hour and a half into a playthrough of this game just being like, ugh, like what the heck? I just got nowhere. But I'm still drawn to want to try again, because finding a way to get those clues, and when they cooperate and when they come together and when you can clear out an area of blight and when you can attack the necromancer and when you can roll that six with a holy relic. I mean, it is really awesome how that all really works. There are 29 different characters in this game, and it's just an incredible amount of content. And you have 13 cards for each. And each of the cards just really presents a different wrinkle to how to approach the game and how the characters can potentially synergize with each other and how they synergize with the artifacts and how they synergize with the different items. And it's so nuts to me just how much content is there, not just from the character standpoint, but you have an event deck, which is huge. You have an artifact deck, which is this big, which I kid you not, I don't think I've had a game yet where I've seen more than two of these, but it's just an extraordinary amount of content. You have the darkness deck, which is up in the corner up there, which is huge. And you only see one or two of those in a game. It's incredible how much content's here. You know, I'm looking at the blights. I have the blights arranged in front of me. I have little piles, like 30 little piles of blights. Some have one, some have two, some have three, some have four. And they're going to be all over the board, making our life very difficult. So I'll get into the rules for anyone who's new to this game and just buckle up. I mean, the game can play pretty uneven, as I've been indicating, in that sometimes you get into the game and you have opportunities to get clues pretty quick. And why are clues important? Well, you need 10 of those to get a holy relic. And why is that important? Well, you need the holy relic before you can kill the necromancer. And I keep saying that, well, is totally ignoring the fact that if you find a way to get enough clues that you can get three of these holy relics, well, you can win the game that way too, if you can get them and get them back to the monastery. It's like, what? And yes, there will be no burning down of monasteries. I'm sorry for all you Maze Knight fans out there. We're going to love the monastery and protect it. That's right. We need to protect the monastery today. So it's going to be a little bit of a different vibe there as well, right? But I hope I present this game well. More nervous than normal that I'm not going to, and that makes me a little sad. So hopefully I will have this sadness lift when this darkest night is over, and it'll be a bright sunshiny day. A bright, 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 bright sunshiny day. Oh yeah. So I should give a shout out to my patron Josh, who recommended this game to me. It was not on my radar at all. And I saw it was Victory Point Games. And I love Victory Point Games, and I love Dawn of the Zeds, and I was just like, okay, let me see what I can do. I got this on BGG Marketplace at a decent price relative to where else you're finding it. I know it can be really hard to find in some areas, and it can be really hard to find for a price that a lot of people are willing to pay, and I get that. Who knows if there will be more printing in the future. I know Victory Point Games has been purchased by new ownership, and there's a whole bunch of drama that's related to that as well. But I feel lucky to have played this game and to have found out about it and been able to get a copy of it, because it just has such a cool feeling to it. I mean, just the art and the characters. And I mean, I hate the little squiggles on these dice, but it's still cool, right? I mean, there is something about this game when you touch it and you have it on the table, it's like, this was made with care. I mean, these cards are great. I feel no need to sleeve these cards. And it's not just because the fact that if I do, they wouldn't fit in this amazing functional tray that the game comes with, but it's just really high quality. Everything's just really, really nicely done, really nicely put together. You don't have miniatures. You have these cardboard standees. I'm not going to use the standees because obviously you're going to need to see who I am and where I am. I do have a mini for the Necromancer that did come at the game. It's horrific. I mean, the only mini in the world that's worse than it is Bravelar's mini. That looks like a badass Necromancer. The mini does not look like a badass anything. I will leave that guy on the board. And I will hopefully be able to orient you to this board and what's in front of us. Now, people who have played this game will note that I am playing on the smaller board. I could open this up on the other side. It is a larger board, a whole 100% bigger. Obviously, trying to get this on camera with controlling four characters and having these cards everywhere, there's no way I was fitting all that in a way that I felt comfortable with. So it is just better for me to do the smaller board. There is one track on the side. That one track will be used to track two very important things. One, it will track the advance of darkness. So I'll put this skull up here. And then two, it's going to track how many clues we get. And again, we need clues because we need to have 10 of them so we can spend an action to pick up a holy relic. All right, and we'll keep coming back to that as we go. Now, the different decks. We have the event deck over here. The event decks just kind of introduce you to all the various things that are working against you in the world that we're in. As our heroes are moving about the world, we will draw one event deck for every turn, except for the turns when the heroes start their turn in the monastery. They will start the game in the monastery, and the monastery is kind of like their safe space. They can go to the monastery, they can pray, they can rest, they can refresh their powers. There's a lot of things that can happen over in the monastery, and I'll get into the characters I have playing with today. I did randomize all of this. It was 29 characters. I played a couple of games off camera so I can get reacclimated to the specific characters. They all do play different enough that I felt like if I had any chance of doing this game justice, I was going to want to do that before I tried to put something on film. So this was all randomized. And as we come back to this game in the future, assuming I do that, then we will try to get through the rest of the characters over time. Again, there is 29 of them. So that is a lot. Now we might see more than four today. If one of our heroes has an unfortunate, exit stage left, then we will bring in another character at random. I do have a spinning wheel app on my phone set up with all 29 characters to make that happen. The deck I'm shuffling now, these are the mystery cards. The mystery cards are going to be the primary ways that we're going to get clues. Now, how we get the mystery cards is going to require searching in different areas of the map. And when we get to those areas of the map and we do a search action, if we succeed, then we will be able to draw a mystery card. The mystery card will go usually in a random location on the board, not always. Sometimes it goes exactly where the hero is. And then it will tell you different ways that you can get additional clues. Usually it comes with one, two, or three clues off the bat. Anyway, these are quest cards. The event cards will instruct us at various times to put these quest cards out. The quest cards have conditions for us to succeed on this quest. And if we do, we get rewards. They also have conditions for what happens if we fail to succeed at the quest in a certain amount of time. That timer is generally advanced by the Necromancer, who takes a turn at the end of every round. However, there are other things that could also shorten the amount of time we have to fulfill a quest. If we don't fulfill a quest, bad things happen to us. Normally darkness will advance, or we have to discard a card, or we have to exhaust our powers, or we have to die because, as I said earlier, a hero can be forced to, exit the game early, but make no mistake, the heroes will die at various points, and what's going to save them from being dead is grace. If you look at all these heroes in front of us, and we'll kind of go into the hero cards a little bit now, is you have two tracks. The top track is the grace track. The bottom track is a secrecy track. The more secrecy you have, the harder it is for the necromancer to find where you are. The necromancer is constantly hunting for the heroes. He wants to find them. He wants to attack them. He wants to do damage to them. If you ever get damage done to you, this is not a health track. This is a how many times you die track. Think of it like cats have 7 lives, right? Our heroes have a different amount of lives based on who they are. Now, the starting values are different for the various heroes. So the nymph has 5 grace and 6 secrecy. Conjurer has 3 grace and 5 secrecy. The paragon has 3 grace and 4 secrecy. And the seer has 4 grace and 6 secrecy. So you see there is a fair amount of variety there. If you were to die, you have to spend the grace. You can keep spending grace. If you have 0 grace left and then you die, well, then you're super dead. And then you come out of the game. And then I have to figure out who's taking your spot. It's a bad thing when that happens, though, because the next hero that comes in, it comes in with less powers than a starting hero. And it also doesn't have a turn until the turn following the turn that a hero has, again, left us and now been departed. So not a great situation. You will want all 4 heroes active. Even losing a turn is sad with the timer that you have and the amount of things you want to accomplish in this game in order to find the clues, in order to control the blight that's going to start gathering around the various parts of this board. All right. So we will go into the various heroes in a second, too. I'll do the flavor text on one. Let me shuffle the rest of these decks. All right, over here we have the artifact deck. The artifact deck is huge. Artifacts are special in that they count as powers as well as items. Items are special because items can be traded between heroes freely, although a hero cannot use an item and then trade it, and then the next hero gets it, also use it on the same round. Item can only be used once a round, and that includes the holy relics. The holy relics are a kind of item. There are 4 on the board. So if we spend 10 clues, we flip this over and put it on a character sheet. The character does have to spend an action to pick it up. And if they begin their turn with a holy relic, their secrecy will start going down because the holy relic is so powerful, the necromancer can sense it and start going toward it. Think of like the Nazgul and, you know, the Witch King and the Lord of the Ring, right? That Frodo had the ring. It was so powerful that Sauron's, you know, minions could figure out where it was and start coming toward Frodo. So it's a kind of the same thing. So if you have it, you're going to want to make sure that you're doing things to manage your secrecy, and then you can go to the monastery and just store it there and then pick it up later. If you trade it to another hero, the hero who gets it immediately loses 1 secrecy again because the necromancer can sense it. So I'm gonna put this artifact deck over here. All right, the next to the last deck we have is the darkness cards. The darkness cards are there to make your life very difficult, and I assure you if I forget a rule in this playthrough, it will be because of the darkness cards. The darkness cards come out of the regimented time. They come out as soon as we hit 10 darkness, and they come out again when you hit 20 darkness. We will only see 2 of these cards. They have quite game changing effects that can be really, really bad depending on which one that you pull. All right, so that is something to be aware of. I'll put these over here. And then finally, we have the map cards. There is a bunch of information stored on these map cards. There are a ton more map cards than this in the game. Actually, here's the rest of the deck. What's really cool about this game is the variety doesn't come in only through the heroes that you're playing with. You also have different ways that you can build this map deck. You see at the bottom, there is a circle of various circles. It's a circle of circles, kids. And the circles have different colors. So what I did is I took only the ones that had the red circle in the corner. The rulebook lists the different variety of map decks that you can build, right? So I'm actually doing the 4th one down. I wasn't going to do the simple one, and I wasn't going to do the classic one, and I didn't want to do the one with everything. So I was really choosing between these 3, and I randomized it with a die roll, and I got entropy. The flavor text on entropy says that the world has fallen into shadow in this subdeck, including every kind of global effect blight. So global effect blights are a certain kind of blight. You'll notice that blights are different colors. We have blue blights, which kind of do things that kind of mess with your powers, some mess with your bonuses, some mess with your tactics, and I'll explain what all that means as we go. Some make searching more difficult. Then we have the yellow blights. The yellow blights are more like enemies. The yellow bites will fight you at the end of every round. If you end your turn in where a yellow bite is, you will generally have to face that blight. And if you fail, you will get a penalty. But now you have these nasty red blights. Now the yellow blights and the blue blights, they only mess with you if you end your turn in that location and you have to do the corresponding things in general. The red blights will affect you no matter where the heck you are. And some are really, really bad. Like Decay here says items have no effect. Well, that's a huge problem because if items have no effect, that means you can't win the game, at least can't win the game by killing the Necromancer. The Necromancer has a 7 defense. So in order to win, you need to roll a 7. I only have D6. Yeah, the only way you can roll a 7 is if you have a Holy Relic. The Holy Relic adds 1 numerical value to your die roll. So you roll a 6 with a Holy Relic. That's a 7. That's how you beat the Necromancer. Right? Now, there are things you can do to mitigate your chances and to make that more likely than not to happen, provided that other things cooperate. However, if a Decay is in play anywhere on the board, well, guess what? The effect of the Holy Relic, it doesn't exist until you go to that place on the board and you kill that Decay. But that's going to be really hard to do probably because there are probably other blights there that are just looking to make your life difficult. All right. So we have these 20 map cards. And not only do these map cards tell us where certain blights will be spawned on the map, it will also tell us what rewards we get if we search successfully in any of the 7 locations on the board. What are those locations? Well, we have the monastery. We actually can't search in the monastery, so I really should have said search in 6 locations, but that's where we start. Again, that's where different things happen. If we spend our whole turn there, we get +1 secrecy. We can heal there by praying. We can do a bunch of stuff in the monastery. And if we start a turn in the monastery, we don't pull from the event deck. Great. Other than that, we have the village in the center of the board. The village has a search threshold of a 3, so it's not that bad to search there. But when you search there, you're unlikely to get a lot of things that give you clues. I think it's only like 4 cards out of the 20 cards in this deck that will likely give you something that will help get you clues so you can get yourself a Holy Relic and whatnot. But the rest of the stuff there can give you more cards to draw, et cetera, et cetera. And I'll explain that in a second. Up in top left, we have the mountains. The mountains have like 6 cards out of 20 that will give you stuff that will help you get clues. And then there's more things there that you can find that will give you like different cards. I think there's a Tome of Retraining symbol there. Like these symbols on the map just kind of tell you what you can expect to find if you were to successfully search. But it doesn't mean that things are equally represented. It doesn't mean that a third of the deck are, you know, tomes, and a third of the deck are mystery cards, and a third of the deck are artifacts. It just means that that's what you expect to find, but it's only about 6 out of 20 in the mountains that will give you mystery cards and things that will help with clues. Now the shot value for the mountains is a 4. So again, you're only going to succeed half the time. Ties always go to the heroes throughout the course of this game. Even if something's rolling against you, like the Necromancer will, ties always go against heroes. The Necromancer will roll against your secrecy. And if he's higher than your secrecy, then he sees you and he's going to try to move toward you and, you know, make your secrecy just go into the toilet. All right, let's go to the top right. We have the castle. The castle, you can find a lot of stuff to help build your deck, but the castle doesn't really have anything that's going to help you find clues. So if when you want to get there early, maybe to try to get more cards, to get more powers, to make you better able to deal with what's going on for the rest of the game, the castle is a good place to do it. And again, you only need a 2 or higher in order to successfully search there. The swamp has a lot of different items that have powerful effects. I'll explain those if we find them as we go. The search difficulty there is a 4. Here's a swamp over here, and that brings us to the bottom of the map. So on the left, we have the forest. About 8 of the cards in the forest deck will give you things that will help you find clues in order to get a Holy Relic in order to win the game. So it's a good place to search. The difficulty there is a 4, but the ruins is really the jackpot. 14 of the 20 cards in the map deck, at least this subset, the entropy subset, are going to be cards that will give us things to get clues. So trying to set up camp there and do a bunch of searching would be a really, really strong strategy that I will try to employ, assuming the various blights cooperate. All right, so this is our map deck. Now we're going to do one more thing with setting up on the board, and then I'm going to kind of delve into these heroes a little bit. So we are going to set this map deck over here, and I'm going to flip over the top card, and this is going to show us our starting blights. Bam. So on the left column, we will list the various locations of the board. So mountains, castle, village, swamp, forest, and ruins. In the top in the mountains, it says oblivion. So we're going to put an oblivion blight up in there. We have the castle. The castle is going to get the shades. Shades, again, are a type of enemy that we will face. This is going to go there. the village is going to have stigma. Oh no, stigma is pretty nasty. Now, stigma means that we have a -2 default grace. What does that mean? I'll get to that in a second when I talk more about the heroes. The swamp has some zombies because naturally, where else would the zombies be? And then we have the forest. The forest also has a stigma, which is really, really gross. So that will be something we want to deal with sooner rather than later. And then finally, the ruins has skeletons. We're not going to put a blight on the monastery to start. Now, I know there is one there, but why would there be one for the monastery? Each area on the map can only have 4 blight. If the necromancer were to try to put a 5th blight in any area, instead of putting a blight in that area, we would put a blight in the monastery. If the necromancer ever try to put blight on the board such that would result in a 5th blight in the monastery, we lose. So we got to make sure the monastery does not get overrun. So this card basically put out 1 blue card. If we end our turn where Oblivion is, we have to exhaust 1 power each turn. If a power exhausts it, it is useless to us, right? Even if it's an active power, it will be suppressed until we ready our powers again. And I'll talk about the actions that can do that. Moving on from Oblivion, we have 3 blights that are creatures. If we end our turn there, we will have to fight the creature. So in the castle, we have to fight the shades. In the swamp, we have to fight the zombies. In the ruins, we have to fight the skeletons. If we lose, there are results. All 3 of these enemies, if we lose our fight at the end, or if we lose our elude attempt at the end, we will take a damage. So a damage is means we will die, except we might be saved by grace if we have any left. You'll also see results at the bottom, including the stigma here, which I'll get to in a second. Every blight has a number in the bottom corner. That is its defense value. So if you were to try to attack a blight, not only would you lose a secrecy because, again, you're attacking these powerful dark forces and the necromancer is going to have an easier time finding you, right? Because it can sense that happening in the force, so to speak. You also need to roll a number higher than that value or equal to it. If you do not, you fail. And if you fail, you get the penalty associated with that specific blight. So if I tried to kill the Oblivion and I failed, I would lose a turn. If I tried to defeat the Shades or the Zombies or the Skeletons and I failed, I would actually take a death again for that. So that's a little bit rough. And those 3 blights all have a defense value of a 5. So if you're only rolling 1 die, which is the default for any test, you can never roll less, right? It wouldn't be rolling because you wouldn't have a die in your hand. But the default is you're rolling 1 die. You're only going to succeed 1/3 of the time. So you do need to find your powers. They're going to be able to beef up how many dice you are rolling. And there are other things you can do to beef up the number of dice you can roll. One of the things you can do is you can meditate on a turn to get a spark. A spark can be discarded at any time by a hero who has that spark in order to roll 1 extra die for each spark discarded, but there is a limit of 3 sparks on your hero board. So if you ever were to get a 4th spark, that spark would just be discarded instead. So a lot there. Let's get to the stigma. What does the stigma do? Well, each of these heroes has default values, right? This is the starting values for where they have their little markers on their cards. So the nymph's starting grace value is 5. The conjurer's starting grace value is 3. However, that default value is -2 for each stigma on the board. Now, it doesn't mean that we virtually have negative health, right? It just means that if I were to heal, a lot of healing effects say that you can only heal up to your default value. But if your default value is considered -1, as it is in this case, well, that means you're obviously not healing. And that could make a huge impact on your ability to survive in the game. So we are going to want to get rid of those stigmas in order to go forward and have the ability to heal as the game progresses. Because right now, the only person that could heal is the nymph, and the nymph can only heal up to 1. So that's not very good. The defense value for both the stigmas is also a 5, and if we try to defeat the stigmas and we fail, we lose a life just for trying to do that. So that also isn't great. This is a really challenging start. Hopefully we can get on top of this pretty quick, and hopefully I get good starting powers. Just to note, there is a fair amount more going on. I'm going to try to get started quick, and then there's a whole bunch of things about items and gold items and keys and stuff that I'll just explain as we come to it. I have these active and active tokens. I have sparks. I have these timer mechanisms that will go with the quest. But in the average game, we'll have plenty of opportunity to kind of address those things. All right, let's get to some of the flavor text. So first we have the nymph. The wilderness surrounding the kingdom is rumored to contain many mysterious and wondrous things, but rare is the day when one of them makes its presence known. The nymph has strange and potent abilities linked to the cycles of nature and motives that few men might guess, but any ally against the necromancer is welcome in the kingdom today. Now, as I said earlier, each hero has an incredible amount of starting cards. It's like 13 unique cards each. It's really nuts. Five of those cards, though, are super special starting cards. So what I'm going to do is take those five cards, now, which is cleverly marked out by just some colorful arrangements in the corners. So I have the five starting cards for all four heroes laid out. And what I'm going to do is choose three of them. Now, I don't want to sit here on camera and choose three of them. And honestly, even when I'm off camera, I don't want to sit there and choose three of them. I just always randomize it and you usually get something that's workable. So I'm going to shuffle these five cards and we're going to take three. And those are my starting powers for the nymph. I'm going to take the last two cards here. I'm going to shuffle them into the remaining eight cards in the nymph's deck. And we're going to put this off to the side as her draw pile. She might go this entire game and never draw a card. It is not unusual for one or two of the heroes to never draw a card in a game. It's hard to get the ability to draw cards. It's one of the things that makes this game so nuts. But you can usually find some really solid synergies in your powers, even with just the 12 cards I'm going to start with. And I said 12. Why? Because I'm going to have three cards from the nymph, three cards in play from the conjurer, three cards in play for the paragon, and three cards in play for the seer. So what are the starting powers I have with the nymph? Well, before I get that, I do want to recommend that anyone who plays this game reads the compendium entry for each hero. This compendium is very well written. It is very clear. It is very awesome. It's like, yay, victory point games. I really like this rule book a whole lot. It explains in very clear terms the hero, what their powers are, some things to look out for, clarify some things that might be confusing. It's really, really good. So the nymph has this whole thing that she works with kind of the cycles of nature, right? So her three powers I have right here are bent bow, which is a tactic. I get to fight with two dice. So every time I'm about to fight, and that's going to include when I'm fighting, defending against a blight, when I'm fighting to try to kill a blight, if I'm fighting against a necromancer, if I'm fighting against something in the event card, I can always fight with two dice. However, if I ever roll a one while fighting with two dice, I have to exhaust that. It's not going to be useful again to me as a tactic until I take an action that allows me to refresh that card. I have Gust. So Gust says that as an action, I can exhaust this card, and then depending on what season it is, I can do various things. In this deck, 4 of 10 of these cards is going to give me the ability to make it a certain season for the purpose of my powers. I did not draw any of my season powers in my opening 3 cards, so a lot of this isn't going to be relevant until I get a season card, but it really does enhance what your powers can do if I do get a chance to get one out of my deck. So Gust, I could exhaust 2. Well, if it was spring, I could search then attack. If it was summer, I could search twice. If it was autumn, I could attack twice. If it was winter, I could gain 2 life up to my default and 2 secrecy up to 7, which is 1 more than my default. And if it's not a season, I could exhaust this just to travel twice. If it was a season, I couldn't pretend that there was no season. So the fact that I will not have a season active does mean that I can travel twice. Traveling twice is a huge ability, which sounds like a little bit lame, I'm sure, but it's everything, right? You always want to be able to travel twice if you can. It's a really nice skill to have, and I am glad I got Gust to start this game. I also have Earth Melt. This is a tactic. I get to exhaust to elude successfully without rolling. It's a really nice way to save secrecy or save health or to get a reward on a certain card if there was a certain reward for successfully eluding. So also happy to have that. But again, it's only one time use until I exhaust it, and I will have to find a way to refresh it before I can use it again. Now let's go to the conjurer. The conjurer shapes ethereal energies into tangible forms, creating weapons, distractions, and other useful devices out of shadow and spirit. Though not strong in a direct confrontation, the conjurer is adept at spreading his influence over an area to arrange circumstances in his favor. With careful planning, the conjurer's creations can be a great help to his allies as well as to himself. Yes, sir. And he kind of looks like Professor Snape. So there is that, you know, he's like a younger, hotter Professor Snape. I mean, it's what it is. So, you know, maybe it's just the green and the black hair. I don't know. I mean, it's Snapey. It's definitely Snapey. So we're going to take these cards. I'm going to take three off the top. Yoink. There we go. And I will go ahead and we will shuffle these other two in. So what are my actions here? Well, none of them are actually actions. All three of them are bonuses. Bonuses can be really helpful. Bonuses and tactics are things that just kind of trigger at appropriate times when you'll figure out when those are pretty quick, and they just don't take actions to do. However, you do need to watch out because some of these blights, guess what? They're like, no bonuses. So for someone like the Conjurer, it's like, oh, I can't do anything, right? Other than maybe search with one die, which isn't all that great. So what do I have? Mirror image. After any hero at your location makes an elude roll, you may add one die to that roll and exhaust if the added die rolls a 6. All right, so it's just basically trying to help out one of my allies. An ally might have failed an elude. It's like, well, I can roll again. I could also use that on myself. I failed an elude. All right, let me add one more die. And if I roll a 6, it's exhausted. If not, we're good. Elemental. After any hero at your location makes a fight roll, I may add one die to that roll. Exhaust if the added die does not make for a success. Duplicate. When a search, event, quest, or mystery causes you to gain an item other than a key, I can exhaust duplicate to gain another item of the same type. That can be really huge, especially if I get some powers early to help me get some more of those suckers out. So don't mind seeing that. The Paragon. The Paragon is an embodiment of virtue who lives his ideals. Able to energize and inspire others by his mere presence, he is a pillar and a beacon to his allies and a terror to his foes. His auras strengthen nearby allies and lend his actions a special flair. Nonetheless, virtue is a fragile thing and requires constant care and nurture in order to blossom. So the Paragon has some interesting things going on. Out of the heroes that we have today, he's the one that's going to be really leaning into this active inactive thing the most, at least based on these starting powers. So I'm going to flip these three over. I'm going to shuffle the remaining two into here. All right, with the rest of the deck here, we have an aura of fortitude. So as an action, I can activate and choose a type of blight. All heroes at my location ignore the effect of that type of blight, but I have to be there, right? The aura travels with me. So I can create the aura on myself. I can choose anybody on the board and say, look, we all ignore that. Well, I can't do it on stigma, obviously, but I could say like, hey, zombies have no effect on us. Or I could say oblivion has no effect on us, but I have to be there in order for that to be a thing. So I'm going to put two inactive tokens here. So why? Well, there are 6 different sets of inactive tokens and they're just color coordinated. So if I go to activate this, what I'll do is I'll name the kind of blight that I'm going to say doesn't have an effect anymore, and I'll just put it here, and this is active, right? So skeletons are now no longer active as long as that's there. Now I could, as an action, make this active on somebody else, and then skeletons would start messing with us again, you know, but it is what it is. So a lot of times I'll be like, hey, where do I want to go with the Paragon? It might take me a couple of turns to get there, but it's like, look, let me say that by the time I get there, these aren't going to affect us, and I could set it up that all my other heroes can come in and maybe we can have a little powwow without having to worry about one of the blights really messing us up. The second power here is a fusion action. Gain 2 grace up to default. My default's only 3. So if I'm down to 1, I can gain up to 3. If I'm at the 0, I also have a chance to get the 3 because if I have an active aura, I must deactivate 1 and all heroes in my location, including me, gain +1 life. It's really huge. But again, until I kill those 2 stigmas, also fairly useless. So those are going to be my first priority in this game, finding a way to get rid of both those stigmas and hopefully not lose too much grace in the process. Finally, we have Rebuke. It's a tactic. I can fight with 2 dice, but if I have any active auras, I must deactivate 1 and I could add 3 more dice. Huge, right? So I can get 5 dice to roll against a blight. I'm probably going to be setting that up to try to get rid of those stigmas right away, because I think that will be really important and just one of the more likely ways to get that done. So finally, over here, we have the Seer.
Last but not least, we have the Seer.
The Seer is a mystical hero able to catch glimpses of the future.
She sees the future, guys.
Ooh. All right. Though not a strong fighter, the Seer is able to avoid danger and aid allies by searching out the hinges of fate, the places and the moments when the future can be altered. With careful preparation and supernatural insight, the seer can topple mountains by divining the perfect moment to act. She is fairly strong, I'm not gonna lie. She has one card where you can like roll dice and kind of storm and use them later, and that was definitely how she took down the Necromancer in this previous playthrough of mine off camera. So we'll see what my starting powers are with her now. Yoink, we'll take those three, shuffle the last two in here, right? So each one of these hero decks are set and they have 10 cards each. So here's the card I was talking about. So we have prediction, roll two dice and add them to this card. I may use all the dice on this card instead of making any roll. When I do, I clear the card. Prophecy of Fortune, bonus, exhaust at the start of any hero's turn. That hero gets plus one die on all rolls this turn. Doesn't even have to be in my location, just a bonus. Great, give you plus one die. That could be huge. And then we have Douse. Douse says exhaust to draw one search result for your location without rolling dice. Oh, how nice is that? I don't want to roll for that search. I just want to get it done. Make it happen. I kind of like where we're at with these powers. I think we'll have a good shot. Let's see what happens. We'll notice these little tokens here. What does that mean? That just means whether or not I've used an action feat to the heroes. I will try to keep this orderly as we go. Doesn't always work out for me because it's like a lot going on. I get excited, but we'll try to make sure that we're doing this in a pretty regimented manner so I don't skip anything and get too far ahead of myself. The hero turn, you're going to check for certain things at the start that might cause you to lose secrecy. Then you draw an event, then you do an action. Your various actions include traveling, hiding, attacking, searching, meditating, doing an action on one of your cards, or retrieving a holy relic, or if you're in the monastery, praying. Those are all things I've mentioned so far as I was just talking through the game. So hopefully none of those sounded like a shocker to you. It's like, wait, you can do what? You should know already. I said it once in the last 40 minutes of explaining this game. Wow. All right, here we go. I'm going to start with the Paragon, right? I think that makes the most sense. Now, all the heroes are starting their turn in the monastery, so we will not be drawing event cards. Additionally, the Necromancer is not at our location, so I will not have to worry about losing secrecy. I can't decide if I want to go to the forest or the village. I think I want to go to the forest. So I'm going to just do my action. Again, I don't have to worry about losing secrecy. I don't have to draw an event card because I started my turn in the monastery and I'm going to travel. When I travel, what happens? Yoink, that goes up to a 5. I'm trying to set it up that I can kill that stigma on 3 turns from now. So that was my turn with the Paragon. The Seer is going to do a prediction. So she's going to stay in the monastery. Yeah, actually I should have stayed in the monastery with him too. Yeah, we're going to stay in the monastery with both of them. I am going to activate the Aura of Fortitude, and I'm going to say that skeletons have no effect on us, just because, right? So I'll put a skeleton up here. I'm going to make this inactive when I try to kill the stigma with the rebuke, but this way I stay in the monastery, and I'm just a little bit safer there. The Seer is also going to stay in the monastery. She's going to roll her prediction, and hopefully I can roll a 5 with one of these 2 dice so I can safely just try to kill one of these stigmas. She rolls a 1 and a 6. Awesome. These are going to go on her card. And then at any point when I'm about to make a roll, I can just use these dice instead. That's very, very strong. Good job, Seer. The Conjurer is going to do this and move here. When you travel, your secrecy goes up to a max of 5. So he won't get any secrecy for traveling because he's already at 5. His turn is done. And then we're going to do the Nymph. The Nymph is also going to come down to be with the Conjurer. Her secrecy is at a 6. So she also will not get any secrecy for traveling. That is the end of our turn as the heroes. And now we go to the Necromancer's turn. The first thing the Necromancer does on his turn is he's going to increase the darkness 1. I'll put the clue tracker on the track now because there is space. And then the Necromancer is here. Now, one of the things I didn't talk about is what are all these little dice put all over the map? That determines the movement usually of the Necromancer. It also determines the placement of things that are placed at random locations, usually quest cards or mystery cards, right? So at this point, the Necromancer already raised the darkness. He would also add timers to any quest that's in play. There are no quests in play yet. So now he's going to try to search to see if he can find a hero. He rolls a 5. I'm going to look at my heroes that are not in the monastery. My Conjurer has a secrecy of a 5. My Nymph has a secrecy of 6. Neither of those have a secrecy that's lower than what the Necromancer rolled. So the Necromancer was not able to locate any of the heroes. He's instead going to move randomly as per the numbers on the board. 5 on the board tells him to go up to the village. So that is where he's going to go. And once he's there, he's now going to draw a map card, and he's going to put a blight in the village to go along with the stigma that's already there. What do we get? He draws some zombies. So I guessed wrong. I said that the skeletons have no effect on us.
I should have said zombies have no effect on us,
but such is life. So that turn ends. Now we go to the next turn. Oh no, I really don't like the Necromancer there. Maybe he will move. Let's do the turn of the Conjurer and the Seer first. I was hoping to move them into the village, but the Necromancer being there kind of makes that not nearly as fun. Not fun at all. I don't know what I'm gonna do with them yet. Let me see what happens with the nymph here. So the nymph is gonna draw an event card because she's not in the monastery, so she no longer has the protection of the monastery. I got midnight. Now the number in the top of the card gives a relative idea of how bad the card is, and the game really, really, really thinks that that darkness increasing is super, super bad. Now there's only 30, and then the game gets really haywire, so you really wanna beat this game hopefully before 20, if at all possible. So midnight is the name of the card. The dead do not rest. We get +1 darkness, and that is that. No direct impact to our nymph, but definitely an impact to the game for sure. The nymph is now going to do a fight action. She's fighting with 2 dice. She's going to go against the defense level of stigma. So I'm rolling 2 dice. We rolled a 3 and a 5. We succeeded. Little gambly, right? But I also had the Conjurer there. Don't forget, he's at the same location. He could have added the die. I was 1 out of 3 chances to succeed. I was gambling that I'd be able to pull it off with a total of 3 dice that would have been available to me. Since I attacked a blight, I do lose a secrecy, but I have gone ahead and destroyed 1 of the 2 stigmas on the board. So that makes me happy. Now, there are only 2 stigmas max, so they both just ended up on the board to start our game here. With that done, the nymph's turn is over. What am I going to do with the Conjurer? Now, I really want to get over here, hopefully kill the skeletons, and again, try to set up camp here and just search. The ruins are an amazing place to search. But I think I might just go ahead and just try to search in the forest and see if I can't jumpstart some things there. So with the Conjurer's turn, since he's not in the monastery, he draws an event card. What do we get? Respite. Shuffle the event deck, including this, and this card has no other effect. Warm fire, decent food for once a quiet night. So got that really early in the game. It's a lot more exciting when you pull it in the middle of the game. You're like, oh my gosh, it's really respite, because sometimes you're just desperate for that card. So there are 2 cards. You do want to make sure that you are reading them right. I was thinking they were the same card for a while, to my detriment, because one of the cards says this card does nothing, reshuffle, and then draw a new card. Respite says, no. You shuffle again, but really, you're good. You don't have to draw another card as event phase. That's a much more friendly experience for everyone, for sure. So I am going to try to search in the forest. I'm only 50% to succeed here, but I don't really have much else I want to do with the Conjurer right now. So the Conjurer is going to roll. We'll see what happens. Give me a 4 or higher, please. I did roll the 5. I succeeded in my search. So I'm going to go to the map card and I'm going to go next to what's on the forest here. The forest says that I get myself an item. Now, this little cheat sheet's really, really helpful, right? Because there's a bunch of symbols here, and this cheat sheet not only tells you what the different blights are, but it'll also tell you what the different items are. So what I got there is a treasure chest. Don't forget, I have duplicate in play. When a search, event, quest, or mystery causes you to gain an item other than a key, exhaust to gain another item of the same type. So I'm going to get myself 2 treasure chests. That goes over there. And because I'm a nice guy, I'm going to give one over to the nymph. When you have an item, you can use it right away. I'm going to turn this treasure chest in to get another power as a Conjurer. Again, his turn is over. So what's the next power? Well, I got portal. Activate in your location. That location and the monastery are adjacent. Heroes traveling between them gain an extra secrecy on the way. That is huge. I'll definitely try to get that active in the ruins. That will be good. So those are now my 4 powers for the Conjurer. Decent start. I would have liked a mystery card or something, but if I was not going to get a mystery card, being able to get a power for the nymph and a power for the conjurer right off the bat is not a bad second place. I could go into the village, even though the necromancer is there, my secrecy would be really, really high. So there's a good chance he won't even see me. So I'm not going to draw an event card for the paragon because I'm in the monastery and we are going to come in here. However, I ended my turn in the same place as the zombies. The stigma is fine. The stigma has this general effect and I'm going to try to kill it. I don't have to confront the stigma right now. I do need to deal with the zombies. Now I have two options. I could fight the zombies. I need to beat a 5, or I can try to elude the zombies. I need to beat a 3. The problem, if I try to fight the zombies, I am forced by rebuke to make this inactive and to roll 3 more dice. I'm going to save that power when I try to defeat the stigma next turn. So I'm going to roll 1 die just to try to elude. I want a 3 or higher. I rolled a 1. I failed. What happens when I fail? Well, I die, so I lose a grace. Remember, I have a fusion, so I feel decently strong about my chance to get some health back, assuming I can beat the stigma, but obviously not ideal. And now we go to the seer's turn. The seer is going to be like, I'm going to come over here too. And she's also going to have the same fight against the zombie. She's going to try to elude for a 3 because she has nothing special here. And I don't want to exhaust the prophecy of fortune just yet. So we're going to go ahead and roll. We need a 3 or higher. I rolled a 4. We successfully eluded the zombies, so we don't take any damage. Again, end of the round effects don't exist on the yellows or the reds other than having to fight. The blues are the ones that have end of round effects that are a little bit different. All 4 of our heroes have gone. We now go to the necromancer's turn. The necromancer is going to add 1 darkness, so we're up to 3. Necromancer is then going to try to find any of our heroes. And one thing I forgot to do, when I traveled the paragon, he went up to 5. So it's going to be really hard for the necromancer to find anybody because all of our secrecies are nice and high, but we'll see what he rolls. He rolls a 2. So he does not find anybody because, again, the lowest secrecy I have is a 5. And where's a 2 going to take him? The 2 is going to take him into the ruins, which is where I want to go. So he's now back in the ruins. He's going to form a blight there. What's the blight that's going to be in the ruins? Well, it is going to be a shroud. That's not fun. What does a shroud do? The shroud protects blights. So that means that I cannot kill the skeletons until I first deal with the shroud. So obviously not great. I was going to try to get a portal there or whatever. The necromancer just keeps getting in my way because he's annoying. So that is the end of that. The good thing though about the necromancer moving is that I don't have to worry about losing a secrecy to start my next turn. Even though we were at the same location, he still just didn't see me. I was still being very secretive. I was being very quiet. I was hunting rabbits. Let's go forward. The seer is now going to draw her first event card, and we're going to do her turn first, and you'll see why in a second. Yeah, that makes sense. Done. What do we get? Panic. Add a timer marker to a quest currently in play. If there is no quest in play, then instead draw 1 quest and roll a die to determine its location, and then add a timer marker to that. He tells a story quickly and out of order is the flavor text there. So I'm going to get a quest card from the top left over here. It's the Rogue Reaper. Now, the Rogue Reaper needs 1 success to get it done. And then over here, you see the timer symbol with the number 5. As soon as the 5th timer is added to the Rogue Reaper card, this card comes out of play and we get the negative effect. What's the negative effect? Well, 1 more darkness added. If we complete this challenge with an action, we can draw an epiphany. What's an epiphany? Epiphany will let any one hero who has an epiphany to draw any card out of their deck by looking at all the cards in it. It's a really, really strong effect. Although it's a fight action versus a 6. If you succeed, you get to put success on there and do it. But if you fail, you do lose a life. Where am I going to put this on the board? I'm going to roll this die. I rolled a 4. So we're going to follow again the dice. The 4 is up here in the castle. And we're going to put 1 timer up there. So obviously this board will get a little bit crowded, but this still feels like the best way to do this on the smaller board side. So I can still kind of have all the cards displayed appropriately. All right, that was the seer's event card. Now the seer is going to go ahead and use her action. What's her action? She's going to fight the blight. Since she fights one of the blights, she's going to lose a secrecy. She's going to use these dice from prediction. And again, I don't even have to exhaust it. It's really sick. It takes a little bit of setup, but it's really, really nice. And I'm going to kill the zombies. Why am I killing the zombies in front of the stigma? Well, I kill the zombies, so I don't have to worry about fighting the zombies at the end of the turn because they're the ones that would confront me at the end of all this, right? So zombies are dead, and now we're going to go ahead and do the Paragon's turn. Paragon draws. He's facing a cultist, so I could fight against the three or elude against the five. If I win the fight, minus one darkness. If I win the elude, no effect. Remember, if I go to fight and I want to do this tactic, I'd be forced to do the three more dice. Don't want to do that, so I will just try to elude that three. Four, I succeed, so I don't have any effect from that. And now I'm going to go ahead and fight the stigma. I'm going to fight with two dice, and since I have an active aura, I'm going to make this inactive. I'll put the skeleton blight back in its little pile over here, and now I'm going to roll a total of five dice. This is a really strong combo. I need a five or a six in order to make the stigma go away. I rolled a 1, 4, 5, 4, 6, rolling really good to start. Now, since I attacked the blight, I do lose a secrecy, but the stigma is now out. So you see, we've been able to combo some nice things there. And end of my turn, that is all she wrote. Trying to figure out what I can do now back in the ruins. I do want to set up camp there. It's going to be the most likely place to go to really get a lot of things to help me find clues to get to a holy relic. Because obviously I have zero clues, kids. Just totally normal and really frustrating. I think I want to see where the necromancer goes one more time before I start totally getting over in the ruins. I mean, I have to fight the skeletons. I don't know. Maybe that makes the most sense. Maybe that makes the most sense. Paragon's secrecy is four, so the necromancer might just head back to the village if I roll a five or a six with him. If I roll a three, he's also going to go back to the village just because of the dice. So, but half the time, the necromancer is going to be going to the village. So maybe I should head over to the ruins and try to start getting some stuff done that way. But I need to kill the shroud before I can fight the skeletons, which is super annoying. All right, so I'm going to go with the nymph's turn. At the beginning of her turn, she draws an event. We add one marker to a thing already in play. It's looking less and less likely that I'm going to be able to take care of this rogue reaper, which is a little bit unfortunate. The nymph is going to just travel. She would gain up to five secrecy, even though her default is six. When you travel, you only gain up to five, so she doesn't gain any additional secrecy. But she is going to turn in this treasure chest, and she's going to draw one of her cards. What does she draw? We have Autumn. So we do have another one of her starter cards. It just happened to be at the top of the deck. As an action, I can deactivate all other seasons and gain one secrecy, and then activate this. When Autumn is activated, two things happen. At the start of each one of my turns, I can gain a secrecy up to seven until I decide to spend a grace, not just lose one. If I spend a grace, and there are cards that will make you want to spend a grace. It's not often, but it does happen. So we'll see. But additionally, that would mean that Gust would give me the ability to do the Autumn ability for exhausting it. And that would allow me to attack twice. It can be really strong, especially because I do have the bent bow in play, which allows me to fight with two dice. And if she's chilling with, you know, Professor Snape over here, that'd be really nice too, because then she would have three dice, assuming she doesn't roll a one on the first one. So she is going to go ahead and end her turn. Professor Snape's like, ooh, where did the nymph go? I'm going to follow her. And he pulls a dust storm. So he gains two secrecy, so he's up to seven secrecy. And then he could either spend, ooh, and then he could either spend a grace or lose a turn. The wind howls in your ears. The dirt scratches your eyes. You circle lost in the half light. There's no way I'm losing a turn. I just want him to be around and able to help next turn. So I'm going to spend one of my grace and we're going to move him here. And obviously he can't gain any extra secrecy. Now, one thing I forgot to do was I needed to elude the skeletons. I'm going to roll against a four to elude them. I rolled a one, so I lose a grace. Don't forget, I have this ability with a fusion to heal everyone one grace. So, you know, I'm going to try to reactivate this aura just to do that. It takes a little bit of setup. Like, I need to activate it, move, like, whatever. But I think in a couple of turns, I can try to get Paragon down here and hopefully work some things out that way. She lost a grace, and now the Conjurer also is going to have to try to elude that sucker. After a hero at your location makes an elude roll, I can add another die. So he would actually have two dice because of mirror image. So he probably should have gone first. That was a strategic error on my part. I'm not going to do revisionist history with that. So he's trying to loot a 4. He rolls a 2. I'm going to do another die because of mirror image. He rolls a 4. So he does succeed. I didn't roll a 6. So I don't exhaust mirror image. So that worked out for Snape. And the nymph is like, why weren't you here first to help me, you big klutz? And Snape's like, what are you going to do? So his turn is also over. So we've gone through all the hero's turns. We now did the necromancer's turn. What happens? This goes up. So darkness is at 4. We're going to add another timer to the rogue reaper. So we're only 2 away from that going away. Again, not looking really good. Just don't see wasting a 6 up there on that. We have other things that we have to attend to. And now we're going to go for the necromancer's roll for his movement. Necromancer rolls. He rolls a 1. Obviously doesn't find anybody. Everyone's secrecy is way higher than a 1. So where is he going to move? Well, the dice on the board say that he moves to the forest, which is fine. He's going to chill over there. He's going to pull a map card to put a blight in the forest. And what's he going to pull? He pulls confusion. Confusion means that we can't use tactics if we were in that location. It is not a global effect like stigma was, but if we're in the forest, we can use tactics, and that's not great. We are probably going to want to use tactics. So something to be aware of. All right, let's go to the next turn. And I am going to try to set up a little bit of camp here in the ruins and hope that the dice cooperate and that Mr. Necromancer doesn't come back and ruin the party anytime soon. No pun intended. I think I want to get the nymph set up that she's attacking twice, because that could really, really make some things better next turn. So I am going to draw an event card for the nymph, Shambling Horror. So compared to secrecy, my secrecy at the time was a 5. I had to face a mummy. I could either try to elude the mummy with a 4. If I fail, I lose a health, or I can try to defend against the mummy with a 6. I'm going to obviously try to elude it, and we still have mirror image. So let's see if this is still successful here, because again, the conjurer is at the same location as me. So I rolled a 1. Conjurer is going to go help me out. He rolls a 3. So I still fail. This is not exhausted. I did not roll a 6. However, the nymph does unfortunately lose another grace. So that's rough. It joints bend the wrong way, making an unsettling noise as it searches for a life on which to feed. And then it was feeding on me and just decided that it didn't taste good, and it just walked away. We are going to activate Autumn. So I'm going to put an active token on Autumn. And let's put another one up here just to remind me that it is indeed active. I gain a secrecy up to 7. And now I have Gust, which will allow me to attack twice next turn. And I think that's totally worth that turn to do that. At the end of the turn, now I have to try to evade the skeletons. I don't want to lose another health. So I'm just going to exhaust Earth Meld to elude successfully without rolling. And that's fine. So now we're going to the Conjurer's turn. The Conjurer draws an event card. We have a dead servant. So I compare my secrecy. My secrecy is a 7, so I have to do a scout. I either need to elude a 5, and if I fail, lose a secrecy, and I don't even have the option to try to fight this sucker. The rotting smell informs you that this one, like most of the Necromancer's minions, has been dead for some time. So I'm going to roll this. I rolled a 2. I'm not even going to bother with mirror image. I want to make sure I have that around to try to evade the skeletons later. So I'm just going to lose one secrecy. My secrecy was already a 7, which is pretty absurd. I'm now going to activate the portal. So I'm going to activate the portal, and I'll put this here. So this location is now considered adjacent to the monastery, and I can travel between them and gain an additional secrecy for traveling. That could be fairly important. At the end of this turn, the skeletons are going to fight me. I'm going to try to elude them. I need a 4 or 5 or a 6. I got a 4 on the first try. So we have successfully managed to avoid losing a grace from them. We're going to go with the Paragon. The Paragon starting his turn in the village. Now notice I still have not started any of my turns in the same location as the Necromancer, because he just keeps moving away. The Paragon is going to lose a health. I don't like it. Forbidden treasure. So I lose a grace. So I'm down to 1. I am going to want to make this active and do a fusion. So I might try to get down there and do some healing. Like, there's definitely things I want to do with Aura Fortitude. Getting there with the skeletons is a little bit dangerous. Maybe I'll stay one more turn, activate this here, then move right. So I'm going to roll 1 die and pick 1. Now, why is this pick 1? If I had sparks, then maybe I could have rolled multiple dice and I could have picked the one I wanted to. So I roll 1 die, but if I rolled more, that's where the pick 1 comes in play. So anyway, so I rolled a 3. I gain a waystone. What's a waystone? Funny you asked. A waystone is something you can discard during your turn to instantly move to any location and gain one secrecy. It is a really, really strong card, and I'll probably use it next turn. And don't forget, as other items, I could give this to somebody else if I wanted to. Waystone, here we go. That will be perfect, because then I can move and I can do a bunch of healing next turn, all in one turn, by spending this turn to just activate my aura of fortitude. And I'm going to say that skeletons have no effect on my fellow heroes if I'm there with them. Ooh, which means I could just travel there now. Yeah, skeletons have no effect. That makes sense. And then I'm going to discard this waystone to move to the ruins and get a secrecy. Thank you, waystone. So skeletons, again, have no effect. We can ignore that dude altogether. And then we're going to go to the seer's turn. The seer's going to pull her event card. Test of faith, it's a 3. Compare your secrecy. My secrecy is a 5. So since I'm a 5, I lose one secrecy and I gain my first spark of the game. It is a bad situation, but you know what you must do. That is right. I'm going to now exhaust her action, and she's going to move. And since she moves and her secrecy is less than 5, she just gets that secrecy right back. She would have to deal with the skeleton. However, the paragon has the aura of fortitude active, and we all can just ignore that. And now we're all teamed up like the Goonies down here. And hopefully the necromancer just goes
a different way,
because I just want to kill those two things. And I just want to start searching like crazy in the ruins. The necromancer's turn. So the necromancer is going to add one darkness. We are up to 5. Yeah. So we played 4 turns and we're up to 5. So like you can see kind of how this like thing just kind of slowly develops in a way that's super, super engaging. We're adding another timer to the Rogue Reaper. Again, that is just going to be a loss. We're just counting that as a loss. And now the necromancer rolls to see where he goes. Please do not roll a 2, a 5, or a 6. He rolls a 2. What a jerk. So the necromancer is now going to move here. And what's he going to do there? Well, he's going to form another blight there, and it's in the ruins. It's going to be spies. So we're going to lose one secrecy at the end of each turn if we are still there at the same time the spies are. Awesome. And by awesome, I mean really bad. So not the greatest rolls of this necromancer. He is not being super cooperative, but I think we're still in an okay place where I might be able to kill a lot of these blights this turn. Yikes. Maybe. Yes, I'm going to go on the nymph's turn first. Before the nymph goes, though, we're going to exhaust Prophecy of Fortune. And at the start of her turn, she's going to get +1 die on all of her rolls this turn. Huge, right? It's really, really strong. So I'm going to get an event card for the nymph. She's going to lose one secrecy because she starts her turn at the same location as the necromancer. Electrical Storm, roll 3 dice, then pick and resolve 2. So be good to me. I rolled a 6, a 3, and a 1. I can lose a secrecy, I can lose a grace, and I can gain a spark. I have to do 2 of those 3 things. I will lose one secrecy, and I will gain one spark. I'm going to lose a lot of secrecy anyway, because I'm going to try to kill a lot of blights in the ruins. The nymph is going to exhaust Gust, and it's going to let her attack twice. She has 1 extra die, and then she has a tactic in play where she can roll 2 dice already. So I'm rolling 3 dice. And so I am attacking the shroud. I need to beat that first. And again, if I fail, we start losing health. So I really need to succeed here. So I have basically 4 dice, thanks to the conjurer, to get this done. So I lose 1 secrecy because I'm attacking the shroud. I rolled 1, 2, 5. Now I did roll a 1. So I do have to exhaust the bent bow. So I don't have access to the bent bow anymore. I managed to defeat the shroud though. So that's out. And let's see about defeating another one. So I'm going to do my second attack now with Gust. I'm going to lose a secrecy because I'm attacking another blight. I'm going to use this spark to roll 2 dice there. And then I get the 3rd dice again from Prophecy of Fortune. I'm going to go against the spies. If I fail, I lose a secrecy. I need a 5 or higher. I succeeded again. So I rolled a 2, 3, 5, managed to defeat the spies. The spies are out, but my secrecy is down to a 2. Not ideal. Really need to get the necromancer the heck out of there. the end of my turn, I don't have to worry about the skeletons because the Paragon says,
don't worry about them. They're fine.
We're now going to go with the Seer's turn. The Seer's going to lose a secrecy because we're starting at the same place as the Necromancer. She's going to grab an event. Dead Servant. So my secrecy is a 4. So I need a 4 to elude or 4 to fight against. I will try to elude it because I still have mirror image here. I got a 6. We succeeded. So that's done. I'm going to use my action to exhaust this to draw a search for my location without rolling dice. So I'm searching the ruins. Please give me something with clues. Thank you. We get a mystery card. It's about time. So our first mystery card, kids, that book symbol means mystery card. What is it? Holy Scroll. So this number here says we automatically get 2 clues right off the bat. Where does it go? It goes in a random location. I rolled a 2. So we're going to look at the numbers on the board. 2 means that it's actually going to go right in the ruins where we are. And I'll just put this right here, which is fine. Happy about that. We're going to read the rest of this. It says, stories tell of an ancient parchment covered in wards and holy sigils. If you can master the magics surrounding it, you may gain valuable knowledge. Action. You can roll 1 die and choose the highest and gain clues equal to the chosen result and discard this card. So that'd be something you want to do when I can get multiple dice, and maybe I can get multiple dice by meditating, or we can do other things to make sure that we're not just going to roll and maybe get a 1, right? We're trying to get as many clues as possible from this Holy Scroll. This is a really good opportunity for us, for sure. So good work by the Seer. So the Seer can ignore the skeleton. Yeah, let's just try to get rid of the skeleton once and for all. So I'm going to lose a secrecy because I start my turn where the Necromancer is. I draw an event card. It is a Mind Blast. Wow. I have to spend 1 grace or exhaust all my powers. Well, that's bad. Yeah, it's really gross picture too. Everything is white and everything is pain and everything is blank. It's like a modern day haiku. All right, well, the change is my action. Instead of trying to kill the skeleton, I will do a fusion. So I spent a grace on that. I'm going to gain 2 grace. And then if I have any active auras, I must deactivate one. I'm going to deactivate this one. So now the skeletons are something to be concerned with again. But I get 1 more grace. I'm back to my default. And everyone else around me can also gain a grace, which I think is cool. Only up to default. So the Seer cannot. That's what she gets for seeing everything coming and not taking any damage. End of my turn, I'm going to try to elude the skeleton because now I have to worry about him. So I need a 4, 5, or 6. I rolled a 2. Mirror image lets me try to roll again. I rolled a 6. Mirror image comes in huge, but since I rolled a 6, this does exhaust. Conjurer has to lose the secrecy because he starts with the Necromancer is. We're going to draw an event card. It's a demon. My secrecy is a 5. So I can try to defeat a 3. If I fail, I lose 2 secrecy. I can try to elude a 4. I'll try to defeat a 3. I succeed. I rolled a 5. I wasted
my 5s.
This whole scenario opens up a lot more if I can kill the skeletons. Or do I just try to search and get the heck out of there because I'm all opened up. All right, I'm just going to search. I don't have duplicate back, but that's fine. The fact that this location is adjacent to the monastery is going to help with some things after this. So I need a 4, 5, or 6 to have a successful search. I got a 5. Great. Draw a map card. And we get another mystery card. This is definitely what I needed. Into the Dark, we get 1 clue. It gets placed in a random location. 2. Oh, it's going to go right here. I just keep rolling 2s. So this is going to get crammed in here. You may uncover critical secrets of the darkness if you can defeat its local manifestation. One thing that I should note, you'll see that this has 1 key symbol. If I destroy a blight there, we cover the key. If all the symbols on 1 card are covered, so obviously there's only 1 on this one, then this card would get discarded. So the most I can get as far as clues from this card is 4, but I do need to destroy a blight in the ruins to make that happen. I kind of wish this was somewhere else, because now I really am committed to staying here until we deal with these skeletons, and that could be a little ugly in the interim. All right, I need to elude these skeletons or fight them. I might as well fight them because I do have the elemental still. So I'm rolling. I need a 4, 5, or 6. I rolled a 3. I can roll again. I rolled a 5, so I was successful. So I don't have to exhaust the elemental because I was successful on the second try. Then that is the end of the conjurer's turn. The necromancer is going to advance the darkness 1, so it's up to 6.
Necromancer is then going to add a thing to the quest that's on the table. So we never got our epiphany. The Rogue Reaper escaped. How unfortunate, but we get plus one darkness because that is the penalty for that specific card. So we're up to seven. Now we're doing a search roll. Please roll a one. I just want a one. A one would be the nicest roll I've ever seen. Well, two, one or two are both good. Anything else is not great. So one or two, Necromancer, he rolls a five. So he does see us. He sees all of us. And if we were in different locations, he would stay with the closest one. Or if we were equally distant away, then you would randomly decide where he was headed. And if we were more than one location away, you would randomly decide what path he would take to get there. So now we have another turn that we're starting with this big jerk, and that's not great. So done with that. The nymph has to get the safety. She's the one that's got the super low secrecy here. So the nymph's going to go first. I lose one secrecy for that. She draws an event card. Dilemma, draw a quest card and roll one die to determine its location. I really like the flavor of this one. So sometimes it seems as if the necromancer was everywhere at once. So the quest card is heirloom. Where do I put it? I put this in two. I mean, you gotta be kidding me. All right. So as an action, I can spend a spark to get a success. If I have one success on here, I get an artifact. If this expires and it only has a three on there, then we get a plus one darkness. A local family prepares to give up their prized possession to secure their safety, convince them there is still hope for the kingdom. Don't want to lose that spark because I need to try to do this holy scroll thing and then draw another quest, roll a die to determine this location. Night terrors, I rolled a four. Hey, something that's not a two. How exciting. This is going to go up in the castle. An unseen menace is stalking the townsfolk under cover of night. Unravel its secrets and let the good people rest easy. As an action, I can roll a die. I get a success for each three plus. If I succeed, then I get a soothing lyre, which isn't that great. But if I fail, we all have to draw events whenever it is that happens. We'll have to figure out how I want to deal with that. The nymph is going to get out of dodge through the portal, and we get plus one secrecy. So we get one for traveling, plus one because of the portal. And let me get to the monastery. Or do I want to get up to the night terrors? Equally enticing. She stays on the board. It's likely that the necromancer will see her and nobody else, and he might chase. That's probably smarter. And there's no blight in the village, so she doesn't have to worry about anything there. All right, that makes me happier. I'm going to do that. The seer is going to lose a secrecy because she starts with the necromancer is. Then she's going to draw an event. Looters, I try to elude. If I win, I gain a secrecy. If I fail, I exhaust all my powers. That's not actually that bad. Panic, fear, greed, they grab everything that's not nailed down. So my elude attempt, I roll the five. I succeed. I get a secrecy. Thank you very much. And then I'm going to do this action on the holy scroll. I'm going to get rid of this spark to roll two dice. Give me something big, yo. I rolled a two and a three. Could have been better, could have been worse. That's going to get me up to six. Really unfortunate thing about that is now, even if I do this and destroy the blight there, that's only going to get me up to nine. And I need to get to 10. So that's perfect. We discard that mystery card. I do need to face the skeletons at the end of my turn. Fight or elude is both a four. I'm going to try to fight it for a four. I rolled a six. So we succeeded. And the elemental is still around. We're going to go to the Paragon's turn. He might try to just kill the skeletons between Rebuke and the elemental. The secret is because the necromancer is there. We draw a card. The event card is refresh all your powers, then spend a secrecy or draw two more events. Paragon's secrecy is going to be garbage, but I think that's fine. Yeah, it's fine. He's at full grace. So I'm just going to spend a secrecy, and then I am going to use Rebuke to fight with two dice to try to just take down the skeletons. And this is going to be a pretty key roll. So I'm rolling two dice. Give me a five or a six. Oh, do I just activate? Tempted to just activate. Oh, no. This is just so bad. Because I really just want to get the shortest blight and get the heck out of here. Maybe I don't spend the secrecy. All right, I'm actually going to draw the two more events, I think. Yeah, I'm going to draw two more events, not spend that secrecy. If I defeat a five or elude a four, I gain a spark. Oh, failure, I get a damage. Is this what the necromancer has wrought? Such an abomination was not meant to exist. It's a vile beast. So I can fight with two dice, try to get a five. This would give me a third die, or I can just roll one die and try to elude for a four. Remember, mirror image was exhausted because I rolled at six. And I have one more event card to come. That spark would be huge because then I could just do that and see what the artifact is. So many artifacts are really, really nice. The deck is huge, obviously, so it's hard to predict. I'm going to fight with the two dice for rebuke and just try to roll a five or a six with one of these two dice. I rolled a four and a one. I get the roll again with elemental. I rolled a two. Oh, so that exhausts and I take a damage and I have to draw another card. Okay, maybe this was a bad idea. I guess I'm definitely not fighting the skeletons this turn. And what do we get? So I'm fighting a tracker. If I win a loot, I have no effect. If I win a fight, I lose a secrecy. I'm losing a secrecy anyway. If I lose either, I lose two secrecy. A rustle of leaves, a creeping silence, a hungry malevolence dogs your steps. So I'm rolling two dice to try to fight. I succeed. There's a five I needed. But I do lose a secrecy anyway. All right, I have to get the heck out of there with the Paragon. He's just absolutely useless right now. So he's going to move through the portal, and he's going to be the one to get the two secrecy. A little frustrating turn for sure. I'm just really trying to get the Necromancer the heck out of there. Conjurer's going to go. He loses the secrecy because of the Necromancer. We get a Runed Golem. I need to elude or fight a five. I may not use powers other than attack this during this event. The hum of the rune work mixes with the grind of stone as it catches sight of you and starts to build up speed. If I fail, I get a damage. I got a five. Look at that. All right, it's a big roll. Rune Golem is out. I am just going to meditate, and I'm going to give myself a spark, and let's try to get this artifact next turn. At the end of my turn, I'm going to fight against the skeletons. I need a four. It doesn't matter how you cut it. So I didn't get dinged by the Ruined Golem, but I did get dinged by the skeletons. The Necromancer's turn. The Necromancer is going to move the darkness meter up, and then the Necromancer is going to roll to see if it finds anybody. It rolls a one. It does not find anybody, and one takes it over here. Nice. Of course, there should have been another blight there. I'm just going to make this the next blight. So in the ruins, there would have been Oblivion. And the result of Oblivion would have been exhaust one power each turn. Who finished our turns there? Well, it was Seer, so that's exhausted. Even if I had dice on there, they would stay there, but the whole thing would be suppressed. And the portal is suppressed. Conjurer went last, so that doesn't change things. Sorry about that. So now we're going to draw a new blight for the forest. What are we getting there? The forest is going to get a void. This counts as two blights. So if we add another blight there, that's four. If we add another blight there, even though there's only three tiles, it would be the fifth blight. So I'd actually have to place one in the monastery instead. That is the end of the Necromancer's turn. So we're going to ready all of this. Remember, as long as this portal is suppressed, I can't even treat those as adjacent anymore. So that's a thing. But there's only a four to defeat. But remember, if I fail, it's going to be a loss of a turn, which is super bad. I think I know what I'm doing with the nymph here. So the nymph's going to draw an event card, blink, roll one die and pick one number. I can only roll one die. I got a five. I have to move to the swamp. Really doesn't matter. So this goes there and then she's going to move up into the castle. I'm going to have to fight against the shades. I need a three or a higher. Nothing I can do to get myself better. I got a two, so I get one loss of grace. Oh, also during the Necromancer's turn, we would have put timers here, and timers here. If I get the liar, I can refresh all powers. That's actually really strong, considering how this is looking right now. The Conjurer's turn, he's going to draw a quest and roll one die to determine its location. I would like a quest that gives me clues. The Mourners. So I need four successes. I can spend a spark to gain a success during my action phase in this location. I may do this repeatedly. I have six rounds to do it, or six timers, I should say. I guess it's not necessarily six rounds. Recent tragedies have left most of the locals in mourning. Comfort the grieving to show your solidarity and unite the people. Oh, how nice. Where is this going to go? I rolled a three. Three is down in the forest. We don't have to put a timer on it to start. It just is what it is. Conjurer is now going to spend this spark by doing this action to get a success. That's all I need. This goes away. We complete it. I'm going to get an artifact and hope for a miracle.
What do we get? The fate's balance. Exhaust instead of making a die roll to use the fate value of one event you experience this turn as your result for the roll. Ooh. An inscription reads, Calamity always leaves a parting gift. The scale must be balanced. That could be really strong. This is a power, though, so it does exhaust. Again, this is power and an item. And this has to exhaust as a result of Oblivion. But I'm going to be able to refresh it once I get the Soothing Lair. Whatever. And what are we going to do here? I'm going to roll to try to go with Skeletons. I need a 4, 5, or 6. I got a 6. I'm trying to think if I should move the Seer. She's not really doing much there. That makes some sense. So the Seer is going to get an event card. It is a Mind Leech compared to Secrecy. My Secrecy is a 4, so I'm facing a mature Mind Leech as opposed to the immature ones. Oh, I'm trying to elude a 4. I failed. Oh, I have to exhaust a power. I have no powers to exhaust. It is what it is. Your thoughts grow sluggish. Your mind wanders. By the time you realize it's an attack, it's nearly on top of you. Oh, nasty Mind Leech. Unfortunately, you're a bit too late. I've been leeched by many things before you came aboard. I'm going to move the Seer to the village, and I gain 1 secrecy because I was under 5. Now, the Paragon starts in the Monastery, so he does not have to draw an event. I'm going to just ready my aura, and I'm going to choose to ignore Oblivion. And I'm mostly doing that to give me either a fusion or rebuke back in the strongest effects. I spend my whole turn in the Monastery. That means I can gain a secrecy. No, I can't. You actually gain a secrecy up to your default. And my default is at a 4, and I was already there. So Necromancer's turn goes. He's going to add a darkness. He adds a timer to every quest in play that has not been resolved. Then we are going to try to see if he can find the hero. He rolls a 1. Doesn't find anybody, but it means he moves to the village instead based on the die symbols on the board. In the village, he's going to add a new blight. He adds some zombies. The Seer is like, I can't get away from the skeletons or the zombies. They're always chasing me. That's how that goes. We are going to refresh all of this. We're going to do the Nymph's turn first, pulling an event card. Evil Day, exhaust the power or draw 2 more events. Something is stirred for the dead to frenzy. All right, we are going to exhaust Autumn, and then I'm going to roll a die as an action. I need a 3 or a higher. If I roll a 1 or 2, I'm gonna be very sad. I rolled a 6. Great, I get a success. That's all I need to get rid of the night terrors. Now I get a Soothing Lyre. I'm going to immediately spend the Soothing Lyre. What happens? That means we can refresh all powers of all heroes. So could not have come at a better time. So these all refresh. The Conjurer is going to get his full-on artifact. These refresh. Make it a little bit tight over here. Kind of Conjurer is really, really very demanding of space here. So these are going to come here, and then we'll refresh these as well. So every single one of everyone's powers, except for the Paragons, were all exhausted. Thank you, Soothing Lyre. Now, what are we going to do? The portal is back up because that is no longer being suppressed. So I'm going to go with the Paragon. Paragon does not need to run event card because he's at the Monastery. He's going to move here. Again, the Oblivion is being ignored, and I'm going to try to just elude the Skeletons. They're coming at me with a 4. My defense, I rolled a 4. We're good. Do need to exhaust the power. Wait, no, I don't. Again, because the aura of fortitude is totally in play. We're going to now go with the Conjurer's turn. The Conjurer draws an event. Count the blights in my location. There are 2. I can spend a spark or lose a health. I lose a health because I do not have any sparks. You failed again. It's always goes wrong. And every day the sky is a little darker. Why even try? That's really crazy. The setback is like some dude hanging by like a rope. He got like caught in a snare in a tree or something. It's like kind of ridiculous. The art's actually really funny and very good. I do like the feel of this game and the atmosphere that's created with all the art and stuff. That has a thing of a 5. I am going to attack the skeletons because forget them. Oblivion I can ignore. I don't need to worry about it. So I'm going to use my artifact. This is exhausted. I get that 5. Since I attack the skeletons, I do lose a secrecy, but the skeletons are finally gone. And since I did that, Well, what happens now? We go ahead and we put a key on this. We get three more clues. So we're up to 9 there, one away from finally being able to get our Holy Relic. Great. Oblivion, again, is still a non-entity because of the Aura of Fortitude, and that mystery card can go out of play. So kind of coming together, looked a little hairy there for a second. We'll see if the Necromancer still stays away. The Conjurer dinging down to the 3 isn't great. So that's going to be something to be a little bit worried about. The Seer is going to lose a secrecy because she starts at the same place as the Necromancer. I'm going to draw an event card and then figure out what I want to do with her. The Host of Haunts, compared to my secrecy is a 4. So I need a 6 or a 6. And if I fail, I lose a secrecy. Honestly, if she stays with the Necromancer, that might not be the worst idea, because then it will kind of keep the Necromancer away from everybody else. And I kind of dig that, to be honest with you. So I'm going to need a 6 or a 6. I rolled a 6. Woo! Like, look at this. That was exciting. I had chills. All right. The hollow moans and shrieks come from all directions, wrapping you in a numbing dread. That was nice to see. I think it's going to make some sense for her just to do a prediction, or she could exhaust. Oh, she does have douse back. We still need another clue. The village is not a great place to get some clues. There's only like 4 of the cards there. I think it's 4 in the village, 6 in the mountains, 8 in the forest, and 14 in the ruins in this set. Yes, I counted. I had to figure it out. I was like, it says I can find this up there, and I can't. Why can't I find this up there? It's like, oh, it's like really hard. The risk of moving the Seer down to the ruins, it just puts me in such a bad spot if the Necromancer comes down there. Because I don't want more blight there. I just don't want to deal with it. I'm fine with more blight getting in the village. The mourners are nuts, man. It must be 4 sparks. I'm never getting 4 sparks. It's so silly.
It's silly.
All right. I'm going to keep the Seer where she is. She's going to do a prediction because I like it. And if I can get a 6, even better. Bam. A 2 and a 4. She wasted her 6 on the event card. I much would have rather that not happen that way. All right. I'm facing the zombies. I need to elude them with a 3. I did, just barely, don't show off. Miss Seer, I appreciate it. And now we can go to the Necromancer's turn. So we get to 10 darkness. At 10 darkness, we have to draw our first darkness card and see if Greg can actually remember all the rules. Anchor, when the Necromancer leaves a location with no heroes, activate in that location. Active, a success when fighting the Necromancer has no effect unless there is a hero in this location. Oh, interesting. Wow. I'll just put it under the Necromancer. Necromancer's gonna see if he finds anybody. He rolls a 6. He absolutely finds everybody. So where's he gonna go? Well, he's gonna stay where he already is, and he's gonna stay with the Seer. And then we do a map. So I'm glad I did that. I did not want him to potentially come down to the ruins. He might have gone to the castle with that roll, because we would have had to randomize who he goes after. We would have still been way more likely that he was gonna come down to the ruins. So in the village, I'm putting an Oblivion. All right. Remember, Oblivions are what my Aura Fortitude is on. And there's only 2 in the deck. So I'm going to put this on this one, because that's where I am with the Paragon. Probably should have done my free search with the Seer instead of Douse. That was probably silly on my part. But I'm just going to do that this turn. So we'll go with the Seer first. Draw a quest and roll a die to determine its location. Tears stream down her face as she tells the tale. Where is this going to go? It goes into 5. 5 is swamp. I can use an action to get 3 successes on there. Then I can exhaust any number of powers to get 3 more successes. I do have to put one of these right on there off the bat. If I succeed, I get 2 treasure chests. And if it expires, I get a decay blight. Decay is really nasty. I do need to avoid that kind of at all costs. And the Seer did lose 1 secrecy for starting in the same place as the Necromancer. I don't mind an anchor there because it's so central. So I think that makes some strategic sense as well. And then I can start dealing with the broken seal. I want to do that next turn. Oh, man. Let me do this search result here while I get the chance and see if I can't get lucky in the village. Come on, give me clues. Oh, she gets a treasure chest. I'm going to immediately turn that in to get another power for her. Bonus of safety, exhaust to start any hero's turn. The hero need not lose or spend grace this turn. Could come in handy. End of her turn, she has to exhaust the power. I'll exhaust the power I just got because of the Oblivion. And she needs to evade the zombie. She's just going to use the dice on prediction because they weren't very good. And we only need a 3. So better. They do search actions with both of these guys in the ruins. I'm likely that one of them will get a 4 or higher so I can search in the ruins and I can just get this last clue. It's obviously a huge concern right now. I do want to get to the broken seal as well. So let me do the Conjurer next. Conjurer is going to be up against a black banner. The emblem bores through your eyes and sinks to the pit of your stomach. Can't the blights in my location. There's only one. And I have to face an archer now. So I have to elude or fight an archer. I will try to elude the archer. It's a 4. I succeeded. We're now going to try to search. I need a 4, 5, or a 6. I rolled a 5. All right, rolling good. It's good. So we're going to search in the ruins. Give me some clues. Oh, you've got to be kidding me. This is where this game's so tilting. I just need clues. I'm so likely to get clues in the ruins, and I get this, and I just don't want it. I got a Scion Stone. Scion Stone is probably my least favorite of the items. You place it on one of your powers during your turn. All heroes may use tactic effects from that card as if it were theirs. May not be moved after being placed on a power, so it just kind of sits there for the rest of the turn. But it has to go on a card with a tactic. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to give it to the Paragon, and the Paragon's going to just put it right on the Rebuke. I don't have a lot of tactics in play with the way this is going down. End of the Conjurer's turn. He doesn't have to do anything because there is nothing there that's going to matter. Oh, and I actually get 2 Scion Stones. Of course I do. I get a second one because of duplicate, and that's garbage, but sure, why not? We'll get another one of these. Maybe there's a thing I can trade on an item to win a quest or something. I think there's a couple of those. Fact that the Science Stone is a yellow type item, which is supposed to be better, is also one that makes zero sense to me. But I digress. That was unfortunate. We got the roll we wanted, and then it just kind of turned to crap. Now I'm not going to duplicate that. I'll save duplicate for something else. It's just really silly. Shoot. So I'm going to go with the Nymph. Dead Servants. Her secrecy is a 3. We need to fight or evade. A 4, she's in a fight with 2 dice because we have our bent bow back, and I did get a 4 and we succeeded. Dead Servant goes away, and we're going to use her action to move here. She's going to gain a secrecy. She ends her turn with some zombies. She's going to have to elude the zombies. So we just need a 3, 4, 5, or 6 to elude the zombies, and we rolled a 3. Yeah, again, really good rolls. All right, good to see. I could put the Paragon up there. I really think I need to keep searching in the ruins till I get that last clue, because it just doesn't seem like it's happening any other way. And I'm pretty sure I forgot to put this here with the Necromancer. He should have added another timer on the Mourners. The Paragon's going to draw an event. He loses his secrecy. I can spend a grace or discard this event without further effect. If I spend the grace, I roll a die. It lets me destroy a blight of my choice anywhere on the board, draw a power card, or move to any other location. Ooh, I'm going to take no further action. I don't think any of those things are the most helpful right now. If I roll a 1, 2, or 3, it's like no effect. So I'm going to now roll and try to get a 4, 5, or 6. I got a 4. All right. I keep getting the search values. Can I finally get this last clue? Oh, I got an artifact. I wish there was like a default that you could always take one clue. I find it frustrating when I have 9 clues and we're already like an hour and a half into the game. You're doing these things, you're going to have a string of bad dice rolls at some point. And it just gets a little bit tilting when you're just like, come on, dude. It just trying to grind to a halt at times where you just keep doing the same stuff and you're just not getting the results you need. But the artifact, anytime you lose secrecy, you may choose not to. This does not apply to spending secrecy. You move through a haze. Even the memory of you is a blur. Okay, that's fine. That's helpful. Start where the Necromancer is or whatever. You just don't have to worry about losing secrecy. I'll put this over here by the Paragon. And that is that. Necromancer's turn. Necromancer is going to advance the darkness. The Necromancer is going to add a thing here. It's going to add a thing here. The Necromancer is now going to roll to see if it moves. It doesn't see anybody. It rolled a 2. 2 is going to mean it comes down to the ruins. Of course it does. Oh, how wonderful. That's so bad, man. That's so bad. I hate it. It's really, really silly. That's really silly. All right, little jockeying down there. We are adding a blight there now too. Of course we are. And in the ruins, we are getting a void. What is the void? Counts as two blights. So these are coming out. That's going to fill the board up really quick. It's also a 7 to kill that sucker, which is not great. All right, let's do this. The nymph is going to draw an event card. She has a demon. Her synergy is a 4, so she can fight against a 3, or she can elude against a 5. She'll fight with 2 dice. I did roll a 1, so bent bow is now exhausted, but I succeeded because the other one was a 6. She's going to do the action on the broken seal. We're adding 3 successes, and then she's going to exhaust. Oh, my bad. I haven't been doing this. She really should be up to a 7. We're going to put 3 on there. I'll exhaust Autumn, so now that power is suppressed, and I will exhaust Gust, so that's suppressed. So we have 5 successes on the broken seal. So someone else needs to just go over there, do that action, and we will get 2 treasure chests. And if her turn, she's going to be up against the zombie. She has to elude them. I'm just going to exhaust to elude without rolling, so I don't chance losing another grace. We're now going to do Seer's turn. The Seer's going to draw an event. I can destroy a blight in any location. I think I destroy zombies. Yeah, I'm going to destroy the zombies here because they're just the worst. Desperate bargain. So I choose 1. I destroy a blight there. What's the downside? Well, I can either discard an item, spend 2 grace, or just get +1 darkness. Let's do +1 darkness. The Seer is going to move to join her friend and get up to 4 secrecy. The Paragon's going to go. He does not lose secrecy because the Necromancer is there because of the Misty Mantle. Anytime you would lose secrecy, you may choose not to. I choose not to. We now get the event card. What is it? Sloppy Search. I roll a die. I roll the 3. I can spend a grace or lose 1 secrecy. I will lose a secrecy. Oh, I choose not to. It's kind of awesome. All right. They clearly do not know how to look. Great. So I choose to lose secrecy, except I choose not to. I'm going to, with my action, search again. I could just keep searching here because I can just keep choosing not to lose secrecy. And the Oblivion's kind of blocked up. So I'm going to search. I need a 4, 5, or 6. I got a 4. Can we finally get it? The ruins. Oh my God. Waste stone. Discard during your turn to instantly move to any location and gain a secrecy. All right. Give me a waste stone. That's so bad, dude. Conjurer's turn. The Conjurer gets an event card. Count the blights in your location. There are 2. I could lose a grace and 1 secrecy. Yup. I will have to do that. The dead are seldom organized. When they are, it's not good. So lose 1 grace. I'm down to 0. Lose 1 secrecy. We have to heal up. I just have too much damage on the Conjurer. So the Conjurer is just going to go through his portal and head back to the monastery. He will like it there. Let's move on. We're going to go to the Necromancer's turn. Darkness goes up. He is going to roll to see if he can see anybody. He sees the Paragon. He's going to stay right there. Awesome. He's going to add a blight. What's the blight? Well, this would have given me a clue. He's going to put some spies there, which are fine because, again, every time I'm about to lose secrecy, I don't. So this artifact is awesome. Before I forget, we have to add 1 to this and 1 to this. Get everyone's action back. Now I'm going to go with the Conjurer first. The Conjurer is going to pray. So what happens when he prays? He's going to roll 2 dice. For every 3 or higher, he gains a grace back. He rolls 1, 5, so he gets a grace back. And then additionally, since he spent his whole turn in the monastery, he gets that back. And also when you pray, you refresh all your power. So he's going to refresh his fate's balance. Done with the Conjurer. We're now going to go to the Paragon. The Paragon is not going to lose secrecy because the Necromancer is there because, you know, he's the Paragon, and he's got a Misty Mantle. I really think he just keeps searching there until we get it. I don't know what else he could do. So what do we get? Gain a spark. Ooh, I'll take a spark. So it's call to action. Got the spark. I draw 1 quest. Roll 1 die to determine its location. It's a zombie horde. A massive horde of zombies has been spotted meandering towards a small settlement. Lead them in another direction before it's too late. The zombie horde is going to go where? I can roll a die. It's a 1. The zombie horde goes up in the mountains. Oblivion is there, but again, I'm ignoring Oblivion. So that actually could work. I could use a waystone and go up there, get the supply cache. This is going to go on here. I just need a freaking clue. I'm like 1 clue away that really having a chance to wrap this thing up. the way it works when you're doing those tests is like you can get one success on the quest for each success you roll. So it's one elude. And normally it's like, hey, I just need one die to be successful and it doesn't matter what the rest are. But when you're trying to do things like that, you're trying to get a number of successes. So if you roll three dice and all three are successful, great. You got all three successes in one turn. You do that, you get the supply cache. The supply cache is actually really nice. It allows you to draw two power cards, keep one, and put the other on the bottom of your deck, but allows you to kind of see more of your cards in your deck and kind of figure out what you want the most. That said, I just think it makes the most sense to keep searching. I'm going to spend this spark to roll two dice. If I can keep this string of luck going, that'd be really nice. Can I get a four? I did get a four. I got a four and a one. Now, if I roll two fours, I could draw two cards, and I could choose which one I want, and that works really well with some heroes. But again, I don't have heroes that are rolling multiple dice and they're searching. So that's why I'm kind of going one by one, which is why I thought the ruins were so important. And I just keep getting a little bit unlucky. Hey, I got a mystery card. This should be what I need. What is it? I get one clue. I don't really care about the rest. The vaults. Rumors speak of secret chambers within the castle holding yet unspoiled riches of treasure and lore. Search them out and claim their bounty. So this goes in the castle. There are two keys on there. I can get plus one clue and gain a treasure chest if I roll a 5+ by searching in the castle, or I get plus one clue and gain another treasure chest if I roll a 6+ by searching there. Both of those are done. We're gone. That's only going to get me to 12 clues. And wouldn't be close to get a second holy relic, so I'm not even worried about that. I got my 10 clues. It's all I wanted. Okay, good. So we'll see how I can maybe make this work in the next turn or two and get a chance to try to kill the Necromancer. Paragon end of turn effects. Again, we're ignoring the Oblivion because of Aura of Fortitude. We would lose a secrecy. Actually, we don't because of Misty Mantle, and the void has no effect. Now notice there are already four blights there. So we get another blight. It's going to have to go into the monastery. And there's four blights there because there's three blights, but the void counts as two. So that makes four. What is up now? I am going to go with the Seer. The Seer's going to draw an event card. Twilight compared to darkness level. The darkness level is at a 13, so I have to exhaust a power or lose a secrecy. I will exhaust a power, and she's going to go ahead and do that action on the card. She's going to put three more successes on there. We have done the broken seal. We get two treasure chests, and I'm going to give one to my friend the nymph. So two treasure chests. So just going to draw one card with Seer, put the treasure chest on the nymph. Ooh. So promise, exhaust and lose one secrecy. Every hero gains a spark, and that includes you. That could be really good. We'll see. Sometimes the powers are like, sometimes they're just like, oh, that's huge. And sometimes you're like, that's not that great. I could have done with something better. But, you know, sparks can be really helpful with some of the quests and stuff like that. If you think about it, from an action economy, if you meditate, you get one spark. With one action, I can get four sparks for the team. That's pretty huge. And now we're here to the nymph's turn. The nymph is going to draw an event. What do we get? It's temptation. I compare it to my secrecy. My secrecy is a 7. I either lose a grace or lose 2 secrecy. I'll just lose a 2 secrecy because who needs 7 secrecy? That's absurd. Remember, autumn is now exhausted, so I don't get that passive power anymore. This would have been a case where if I spent a grace, I would have had to make this inactive. So I don't really want to spend the grace. We'll just do this. Then we'll put the treasure chest in. See what this power is. So it's winter. Deactivate all seasons, gain one grace optional default, plus one die when fighting, plus one die when eluding, and your powers cannot be refreshed. Huh. Not sure that's the greatest thing for me, but I do want to refresh my powers. If I hide, I can refresh my powers and gain a secrecy up to 5. I'm already at 5, but I would start getting the benefit of autumn again. And I think autumn makes more sense with a gust. So I'm going to go ahead and hide. Refresh all my powers. I do not get any more secrecy though. I can get a holy relic pretty soon, but I'm going to need like one more turn, I think, to get everyone together up in the swamp. And we see if we can end it there. Now, one thing I should say, when you're trying to kill a necromancer, if there is a single blight in the necromancer's location, an attempt to kill him will not succeed. Instead, if you succeeded, all would happen to Set is he would just protect himself with the blight that's in the area thematically. And then that blight would be destroyed instead of the necromancer. So you really need to get the necromancer in location, kill all the other blights, and kill him all in the same turn. So it does take some bit of coordination. And I kind of like what I'm looking at here as a way to make that happen. Necromancer's turn. Darkness goes up to 14. We're going to put another timer on this. Stigma's probably going to come into play. There's not much I can do about that. Necromancer's going to see if he can roll to see anybody. He rolls a 3. He actually does not see anybody because the Paragon's at a three because he hasn't lost secrecy in like seven turns. The Conjurer's at a three. The three instead is going to take the Necromancer, I believe, to the village. Yes. Anchor still hasn't triggered. He hasn't left the location with no peeps yet. And he's going to add another blight in the village. So we're through the map deck, so we'll reconstitute that. He's adding another zombies over in the village. So I think the swamp is still setting up as a really nice location to try to pull this off. We're going to refresh all of our powers. I think the Conjurer is just going to pray again. Right, let me do this. The Conjurer is going to move. This is still adjacent, so he's moving there. He gets a secrecy for traveling. It's plus one secrecy because of the effects of the portal. I'm going to give him the Waystone as the Paragon, so I can do that at any time. And then I think the Conjurer is then going to use that Waystone to move here and gain another secrecy. Only got one grace, but that should be okay. The Paragon is going to draw a card. His secrecy is a three. He compares this. He's facing a large horde. He needs to either elude or fight. He's going to elude against a four. If he fails, he loses the grace. He rolls a two, so we fail. Again, I didn't want to fight it. I would only roll one die anyway, unless I used rebuke, and I don't want to do that because I don't want to deactivate. Or a fortitude, so I'm going to move here. Orifort is not really doing anything for me right now, but it's putting me in a place where I can unactivate Aura Fortitude to actually roll five dice or rebuke. So the Paragon is down. He gets secrecy because he traveled. I'm worried that our secrecies are all too good and the Necromancer is not going to find us because he goes in there on a five or a six at this point.
Everyone's secrecy is too good.
That's a funny problem to have. The Nymph's going to go. She's going to draw an event. The Horde. At the beginning of her turn, she gains one because Autumn is still active. So she's facing a small horde. She's going to try to elude. She needs a three or higher. She rolls a six. So that's good. Going to actually deactivate Autumn and activate Winter. That's going to give me an extra die when fighting. And remember, I'm going to need to not only be able to fight and kill the blight that's going to be on the land if the Necromancer gets there, but also going to need to fight the Necromancer himself. These inactive symbols on Autumn. And now the Seer is going to draw. I could spend a grace or turn all my rolls into ones this turn. Your bag rips, a branch catches your belt, the horse loses its shoe. Something is wrong. All my things being one this turn is fine. I'm going to exhaust promise. I'm going to lose a secrecy. It gets down to three. And I'm going to give every hero a spark. I have a very tight window where this might be able to come together. All right, Necromancer's turn. The darkness goes up to 15. Necromancer is going to roll to see if he sees any of us. He needs a four, five, or a six. He gets a four. He would not have seen me had I not lost that secrecy by doing that. That's actually why I did that. So he comes here. He's going to leave the anchor behind in the village. So Necromancer is also going to do this. We get a stigma blight in the forest. It did not take care of that. So minus two default grace. We get a third thing here. And we create a new blight in the swamp. What's it gonna be, kids? Now, one of the things that really stinks about the voids is they count as two blights, and they also have a seven defense. That means the only way you're defeating those is similar to the only way you're defeating the Necromancer is that you need the Holy Relic. It's kind of nice that they're out in different locations, but there's still one more, and if we ended up putting this in the swamp, that'd be really bad. I have a very, very specific way that I can pull this off, and I'm gonna need to get a little lucky, but I kind of like where I'm at. Remember, I can't kill a Necromancer until I have someone over in the village because of the anchor. Hello, darkness. All right, adding a blight to the swamp. What is it? The Enigma, plus one search difficulty. That's going to have to go before we can kill the Necromancer. All this stuff flips. Someone's going to need to spend an action to pick up the Holy Relic. Then we can transfer that. Someone else is going to need to roll to kill the Necromancer. Someone's going to need to kill the Enigma, and someone's going to need to move to the village. I can get seven dice for the Paragon, and I can roll with four dice with the Nymph. So I think I'm going to go with the Nymph first to make sure I kill the Enigma. The Nymph's going to lose one secrecy because she starts in the same place as the Necromancer. She draws this event card. She has patrols compared to Darkness. Darkness is at a 15. So I'm fighting a Lurch, a 5-5. I'm just going to exhaust Earth Mel to elude without having to roll, and this is not a thing. Now, we are going to roll. I'm going to fight the Enigma. I'm going to lose a secrecy because I'm fighting a Blight. I'm going to use this Spark, so that gives me one die I have two dice because of bent bow, so that's three dice, and I have four dice because of winter, because I have plus one die when I'm fighting, and I can't refresh my powers, so I just need a four with one of these four dice. I rolled a 5, 6, 3, 3, so that's enough. Let me kill the Enigma. So now the Necromancer can be defeated. Did not roll a one, so bent bow doesn't break. That's right. Poetic. I'm going to go with the Seer. Minus one dark. Oh, you've got to be kidding me. That's so bad. All right, minus one darkness, but I create a blight in my location. So much for killing the Necromancer this turn. I just do not have the actions. The blight in the ruins is going to be spies. That's bad. All right, so we're going to have to do this all again. What is she going to do now? She is going to... Oh, man. She's going to spend her action to spend 10 clues to get the Holy Relic. And before I forget, we had a loss of secrecy at the beginning of the turn because of the Necromancer. We have the Holy Relic. Flip it to its Holy Relic side. The Conjurer is going to lose a secrecy because it starts his turn with the Necromancer. He's then going to do his event card and hope for a power of a 5 or higher. It's a 1. Almost the same thing. Fighting the Guarded Trove. So I have to fight a 6 or 6. If I win, I lose a secrecy and draw a search result. If I fail a fight, I get a damage. If I fail an elude, I spend a secrecy or draw another event. I'm going to go against the elude. I got a 3. I'm not even going to try to reroll it. It's not worth it. So I just lose a secrecy. I'm going to get the Holy Relic from the Seer. That means I lose another secrecy. I'm attacking. I'm going to use the spark. So I'm rolling two dice. I'd have a third die if I fail. This would be the only use possible of the Holy Relic this turn. So I won't have it available to me if I wanted it for the Paragon. I need a 5 or higher to beat the spies. Now I just need a 4 or higher because of the Holy Relic because I get plus 1 to my rolls. I rolled a 1 and a 6. I lose a secrecy because I fought the spies. The spies are now dead. Still cannot take care of the Necromancer because I don't have anyone here. But I can send someone there next turn. The Paragon's going to lose a secrecy because he's at the same location as the Necromancer. We're going to draw an event card. Midnight, the dead do not rest. We get our darkness back to 15. And with my action, I'm going to take another spark. We're meditating, people. That's right. Now we go to the Necromancer's turn. The Necromancer gets the darkness up to 16. Now he's going to roll to see if he finds us. He rolls a 2. He does not. Wow. No. No, that's really bad. There's actually one thing where you control the Necromancer's movement. Is do not have it in play. 2 moves it back to the village. Oh, you're kidding me. We're right here. I mean, I could not have lost more secrecy in one turn if I tried. Oh, it's bad. All right, so the Necromancer is going to come here and go back to the village. And in the village, he's going to add a blight, and it's going to be confusion. Yes, I'm very confused. Now he just didn't roll higher than a 2. Wow. We would have put a 4th thing on there. Oh, I forget. Obviously, that is not a thing that I'm doing. So we'll get some zombies up in there. So the rest of the world is going to look like garbage except for the swamp, which totally makes sense how that's going to work out. Everyone's going to get their action back. And now we go to the hero phase. All right. The Conjurer is going to lose a secrecy because he starts his turn with the Holy Relic. We're going to draw an event. The Horde is a 3. My secrecy is a 1. So I'm facing a giant. Oh, I might die as a Conjurer, which is super bad. I need a 5 or higher to elude. I rolled a 5. Very lucky. All right, that's out. The Holy Relic only works as plus 1 when fighting. And I could use that at any time during the turn. I am going to have to pass that on, though, because it's killing me. Don't have a lot of secrecy to go around. Obviously don't want to go back to the monastery. Doesn't make sense for that. Conjurer is going to search with a 4. We succeed. So we're getting a item from the swamp. It's an epiphany. Now the epiphany does not count as an item reward. So I just immediately will get this. I search for my power deck and take the card of my choice and then shuffle my deck up. I will fight or elude with 2 dice. Notice I could have been fighting with Rebuke, but I'm not sure if the Scion
stone means that I would have to unactivate. So I've been really reticent to use that until I use that aura of fortitude. So I get some stone spikes. So it gives me ability to fight or elude with two dice. That could really compound well with elemental and whatnot. So that search was successful. We're going to now do the seer's turn. The seer draws an event. Watchers compared to darkness at 16. So I have to elude a 5. I succeed again. I would have lost the secrecy otherwise. So again, rolling really well. I'm going to refresh my powers and gain the secrecy by hiding. These powers could be nice. Feel good about that. Her turn is over. I draw an event with the nymph. Now I can't refresh my powers as long as winter is active. Renewal, reshuffle the event deck and draw another card. This is not an event. So again, that's the other one. It's not respite, which is really nice at this point in the game. We got renewal instead. So we will have to draw another card after I shuffle this thing up. Obviously a lot of cards I don't want to see. Getting the card that adds a blight to the location is super bad when you're trying to kill Necromancer. The good thing is we already have the relic. So in theory, we would be able to move somebody into the village to deal with the anchor thing. You know, we'd be able to defeat two blights and hopefully defeat the Necromancer as well. We're still going to need to get a 6 the way this is shaping up. I was hoping to get prediction and get a 6 on there, but I just don't think that's happening at this point. So we're going to draw this event card for the nymph. I lose a grace. I roll 1 die and I pick 1. I got a 2. I gain a charm. So the charm gives me a reroll ability. I can reroll my dice. That could be really huge. We're going to go to the Paragon's turn. The Paragon draws an event card. Spend a grace or exhaust all my powers. Oh, I have to spend my last grace, not exhaust all my powers. All right. Comes down to the wire. That was not the card I wanted to see. On his turn, he's going to meditate and gain another spark. In seriousness, I'll be rolling 8 dice. And I just need 1 6, assuming I get the Holy Relic. All right, the Necromancer is going to move the darkness up to that. We get our 5th thing on here. We get a Zombie's Blight up in the mountains. Last Zombie's Blight, that goes away. The Necromancer is going to cheat if he can find us. Rolls a 3, does find us, comes here, putting a Blight in the ruins. Make it not awful, we get some Taint. Taint does have a defense of a 5. We fail to defeat it, we lose a life. So I have to be careful, right? If somebody dies, it's not good. I need someone alive in there. And there's a lot of things that can go wrong in those final battles. So I think I need to go first with the Conjurer. The Conjurer can fight the Taint. The Nymph goes there. The Paragon kills the Necromancer. The Conjurer is going to go first. The secrecy goes down to 0, both because of the Necromancer and because of the Holy Relic. Necromancer is present and my secrecy is 0. I have to combat Necromancer. Now, the beginning of my turn, I'm going to exhaust the Prophecy of Safety to say that the Conjurer cannot lose life this turn. I make sure he survives. So he's fighting with the Necromancer. He is not going to be using the benefit of the Holy Relic. I'm telling you that right now, because you need to announce these side of things. I'm fighting or eluding with 2 dice. I'm fighting with 2 dice. So the Necromancer has a 7 value for defense, but a 6 value for elude. So I'm eluding with 2 dice. I did not roll a 6. So I could try to see with mirror image, but again, I'm not taking the damage anyway, right? I failed, but I don't have to lose life because of the Prophecy of Safety. The Conjurer is going to give the Holy Relic to the Paragon. I think I might have lost a secrecy. I didn't need to last time, which is fine. When the Paragon would lose secrecy, I may choose not to. So I chose to lose it once because I'm silly. I'm not choosing to lose it again. The Conjurer does not pull a fate card, which is a little unfortunate because of fate's balance. So he's actually going to give this relic over to the nymph. And because he doesn't have to lose any health this turn, I'm going to send him on a journey there. He gets 1 secrecy back. He's going to have to fight the zombies. I need to elude. It's a 1. I fail. I would lose health, except I don't because Prophecy of Safety. I fight the other zombies. I need to elude. I succeed. We're good. So all that works out. And I could have fought or eluded with 2 dice. It just doesn't matter. I just protected myself with the Prophecy of Safety. That's really huge. And now I'm satisfying the anchor card. Again, our only darkness card that's in play, which is actually a really cool darkness card. The nymph. The nymph loses a secrecy because she starts her turn with the necromancer. Additionally, I'm going to give her plus one die this turn. She draws an event card. If it's high, she has Fate's Balance, which would be strong. Now it's low. Two, lose a secrecy. I can now spend a grace or discard without effect. I think the upside of this is too high at this point, so I am going to spend the grace. If I roll a six, that'd be huge. I did not. One, no effect. She is going to attack the taint. She's going to fight with two dice and a third die and a fourth die. And we need a five with one of these dice. And if we don't get it, that'd be very sad. So if she's fighting with a five, she got a 5, 1, 3, 2. We did it. That exhausts. I rolled a one, but we killed the taint. She loses the secrecy because she attacked taint. Now we are using a holy relic in this battle. We're going with the paragon. So I just checked. I did lose the secrecy with the paragon last turn. I shouldn't have because of Misty Mantle. So I am up to four. We draw an event card. Demon. All right. Compared to secrecy, I'm a four. I need to elude a four or defeat a three. If I fail, I lose two secrecy, but I don't. So that's fine. I'm going to try to elude a four. I got a five. So we succeeded there. Now, moment of truth. I am going to use rebuke to fight the necromancer. I'm fighting him with two dice. Oh, and the nymph is going to give me this item. So I actually have a reroll here, which is pretty ridiculous. So I have two dice. I'm going to use these three sparks to get three more dice. And because I have an aura active, I'm going to make that inactive. So this comes down and I get three more dice and I have to deactivate it, but obviously I want to. So I have eight dice. I need 1 6 and I have no grace left. But who needs grace when you have a Misty Mantle? Yeah, I think we're good. This is for all the marbles. Can we do it? All right, eight dice. I need 1 6. Just one time. Booyah! 6 6 5 5 5 4 2 1. We have defeated the necromancer and saved whatever this world is from his evilness. Oh, man. It's really good, man. I just hate when you're just grinding for that last clue. And I think I just need to lean into it a little bit and just kind of feel like the journey of that. But I can't think of another game where you're just stuck, right? And then sometimes you can get those 10 clues really quick. And sometimes you just have to drag through it, just praying that you can figure out a way to get those last two clues. And we had a strategy, camped out in the ruins, just were able to work out a lot of the magical stuff there. This Fate's Balance came in big once, but obviously we kept drawing low fates with the players who had it. So it wasn't that great. Misty Mantle was huge. I mean, that's like the MVP. That might be the first time I've seen an artifact really just carry a game like that. You see how all these powers really start gathering up. I love the Conjurer. I think he's really strong. I ended here with this reroll ability, which is really nice. At some point, you're like, all right, you need a six to win, but it's like, all right, you can really, really get a nice combination of things to come together where that six is almost like a foregone conclusion. As I said, the last time I played with the Seer, I was able to really do this prediction ability until I rolled a six, and now I'm just going to keep rolling until we get a six to show how that works. Yeah. And I had a six and I was like, okay, I guess I'll give the Seer the relic and just boom, she just went to town, but really had to grind it out to get that 10th clue. That was really nuts and just kind of made everything a lot harder. And all of a sudden this starts getting crowded. I mean, if you place one more blight there, it has to go here. You place one more blight there, it has to go here. Down here, we place one more blight here, it has to go there. So we already had three locations that would have started to feed blight to the monastery. So you're like, all right, let's get ourselves to a place. All of our secrecy wasn't great. Let's make sure he gets there. And he's just like, all right, bam, bam, kill a blight, kill him. Or, you know, as it happened, kill a blight, kill another blight. And hopefully you can do this again next turn. You know, it just kind of was one of those things. And then the stupid necromancer went across and we're like, ugh. But this anchor is an interesting card. I don't mind that darkness card. These darkness cards can be really brutal. You do have some of them that will start digging into your grace, which is pretty nuts. You have some of them that it's like, if you kill a blight, if there's one in an adjacent location that comes in, that's super hard. This is definitely one of the more forgiving ones. The cursed ground, whenever a hero destroys a blight, that hero loses a grace. I mean, these are really sick. This might be the tamest one. I mean, I like it thematically, right? But it's not bad. You lose one hero. Putting it in the village, I think it was clutch, where it's like, all right, let me make sure that he leaves that there, because then we're just one thing away. That portal was pretty huge. That was a really fun card to mess around with. There were a lot of fun cards. I mean, I hadn't really seen the Spike Stones. I really love how flexible that is. Getting into Winter was cool. I liked that a lot and really just able to pull this out. But yeah, these are so many dark. I mean, how many games did you have to play without like cheesing it? I mean, I could see someone saying, you know what? I never shuffle this deck and I just want to go through the whole thing. And then you can get through it in, you know, what, 40, 50 games, maybe. I'll never see all these cards. I will absolutely never see all these cards. And I will never see all the artifacts. And, you know, I'm like, oh, some of them are really cool. I mean, some of them I've gotten. I'm like, oh, really? I just wanted the clue when you gave me an Aegis. Exhaust instead of dying or losing a turn. That's pretty strong.
That could be really nice.
Yeah, I mean, the way they work as both powers and items, I think, is pretty cool and pretty flexible. I really did not expect that soothing liar to come together. There's so many words that I feel like liar is a word that I feel like I always say wrong. Taint is like, come on, man, really? Could we have called that something else? Like, I'm like four, I know, it's bad. But, you know, it's one of those things. It really just kind of adds to the overall way this game is put together. So yeah, it's a good one. My favorite games, I go through periods where they just frustrate me to no end. So, you know, at times when I get frustrated at a game, it's not necessarily a bad sign. That one part of the game, just give me a default. Give me a default. Hey, if you pull an item as a default, you can always take one clue. I just think that would make a lot more sense, because then at least you just have some idea of like, all right, well, I got unlucky with searches four times in a row, but at least I'm getting a clue every time and you feel like you're moving toward. And I rolled really well. Like I rolled really well. And you saw how arduous it was for me just to get to a 10th clue. I mean, I can't even fathom how someone would get 30 clues and get all three relics back to the monastery. And I guess if you got some of these heroes that have amazing search powers, as I said, if you search, you roll three dice and you get three successes, you'd have to roll really well. But then you could say, all right, I'm going to look at the next three cards and I'm going to choose what I want my reward to be. So if you could do that enough, maybe you could really cheese it and get enough clues. But man, it's such a grind to get 10. I mean, I always find myself struggling to get 10. And it could, again, just be the heroes that I've naturally gotten used to and my natural tendencies in games. I mean, people have noticed that I'm a little bit more aggressive. So, yeah, like Maze Knight or Spirit Island are the kind of protagonists that I tend to resonate with these games. I'm out there loving tantrum, you know, it's like too many bones. It kind of works for me, but good game. I will try to get it back on the channel in a few months. These are longer games. There's a lot going on. There are a lot to film, a lot to edit, but happy to get this first run through out there. What did you think? Questions, comments, epiphanies. If I have any rules, mistakes, please let me know. This is the first time I'm putting this on the channel. I do expect that there is one or two little things that I just missed in the rules. Please do not feel bad or be shy about pointing that out. The greatest place to go on my videos after a couple of weeks is you want to go into the comment section, look at the pinned comment I put in. If there is a rules mistake, I will, more often than not, I will mention it there so people are aware, because I don't want to give bad information out there. I want to give a shout out again to Victory Point Games and to Jeremy Leinert. This is just a really, really cool game. Glad to have it. Glad to own it. It's, you know, when I'm looking for a longer, different kind of thing and I'm ready, I'm ready to try to deal with the frustration of getting those clues, because I'm not always ready for that. But when I'm ready for it, this game is here, and it's a really nice feeling when you can pull it off and when it comes together. And it's a really fun feeling when it's like, oh, we got so close and it just didn't happen. I've definitely had some games like that. The one time I was actually able to play this with a friend, we were just about to pull it off, you know, a window open, we had one shot and it didn't work out, and it was super fun. It was like, all right, cool, that was just really just a good time, and happy to get back to it. Do want to show off more of these heroes too. These heroes are all very different and they're all very cool. So I am yammering because I am tired, because that was long, but we'll get it edited up. We'll get it out there. If you want to see what's coming up in Soul Playthroughs Land, as I always say, go on my Patreon page. I have a link in the description below and you can find the schedule for the upcoming month. About a week before every month is when I put those out.
Also, you can see the different tiers of patronage if supporting this channel is something that you are able and or willing and or excited to do. That would be amazing because I would love to get some more support for this channel as I keep trying to grow it, getting it bigger and better going forward. And that's about it. We will be back. Look out for a live playthrough of level 5 of Dawn of the Zeds, 3rd edition. I'll be doing that on the channel as a celebration of my 2-year anniversary. 2 years! Can you believe it? I can't. It's been crazy that it's already been 2 years of me doing this stuff. But yeah, so 2 years, I'll be doing a live playthrough of level 5 of Dawn of the Zeds, and that's going to be super fun. So it'll be really long, but it's like, hey, let me do something crazy to commemorate 2 years in the biz, so to speak. And Dawn of the Zeds is indeed my favorite game that I learned about through this channel. It's so cool. It just works for me in so many ways. And again, obviously, it was a big reason why I was interested in seeing what Darker Night was all about, just being from the same publisher and whatnot. So that's all for now, for real. Until next time, happy gaming.